Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Permadeath Podcast, episode 29. I am Bill, as always, and today I am joined by Kinross, by his lonesome.
I'm joined by what is now 10 donuts. I've eaten two of them. I've eaten two of them since we started this call.
So, what kind of donuts are they?
Krispy Kreme.
Oh, damn it!
Yeah, I've had I've had the plain ones first. I had a chocolate sprinkles one and just this general glaze. I've got two chocolate and custard, two Nutella, two Reese's peanut butter, two Biscoff, and one strawberries and cream, and one chocolate orange.
Jesus Christ.
I saw a Reddit post about donuts this morning, and I was like, damn
it. Got the craving. I hear you. I'm kind of jealous. You said you have 10 donuts left?
Yep.
That's the same amount of donuts that Edge gave Breath of the Wild.
Oh, my Lord.
So...
That's impressive.
So, yesterday was the end of the preview embargo for Breath of the Wild. Now,
five hours?
Yeah, first area of the game, that little tutorial area. Now, I'm not going to go into detail out of respect. I don't know if you're, like, total blackout until you get it, because you're definitely getting it. So, like, it would make sense for you to know as little amount as possible. Or I'm sure you'd want to anyway, know as little.
I'm getting my information from people that I know are also, like, pretty anti-spoiler in most ways. So I'm following Game Explain.
Okay, cool. Yeah. So you've been, like, paying attention to the preview coverage and stuff from them, like the videos and everything? How?
But because they're, like, really, we don't want to spoil anything, and we're really pissed that the NDA spoils stuff for us, I'm like, okay, cool, I'll keep an eye out.
Yeah, that's a bummer, huh? I never thought of that. Yeah. Like
don't talk about these things. Oh, no.
Fucking thanks. I wanted to read the conclusion of the Edge review. It's like their little summary paragraph. Because I've been reading a lot of quotes from previews. And first, I just want to say the previews for this game are absolutely stellar. And it fills me with envy because I'm not getting the Switch until Splatoon. Now, technically...
You're not getting it for the Wii U, I thought.
No, if I'm going to buy the Zelda, I'm going to get it on the Switch whenever I get my Switch.
Okay.
It just feels right.
Oh, you're not going to be able to take part in the test fire.
Yeah, I'm going to miss the Splatoon test fire in March, which is a bummer. But I mean, technically, okay, I thought about this morning.
Are you going to try and get a Switch for the test fire?
I thought to myself, if I really wanted it, if I really right now, like after we hit stop on this and I went down and I had some toast and I thought about it over some toast, I could buy one, technically. It wouldn't be smooth, but it wouldn't put me in a rough spot either. But there are other games coming out in March that I want and will be devoting time to, like Mass Effect, which is my big one for March.
Yeah.
But I'm going to be honest with you. Like after consuming all of that preview coverage yesterday, it's really hard not to. Just pull the trigger because like the game like looks amazing, like absolutely.
For what it's worth, I haven't read the Edge preview yet because I don't know if it's available to non-subscribers. And I'm gonna pick it up on Thursday or Friday.
Okay. Would you prefer I not read their conclusion paragraph?
No, you can read the conclusion
because I think it's pretty high for Zelda. Now I want to say, the only reason like I'm not like full in 100% on buying the Switch right away. Like, it was pretty evident always that Breath of the Wild was going to be a great game. It's a Zelda game, and, you know, everything leading up to this moment has clued us in that this game would be worth it on any level, no matter what platform you're playing it on. The only reason I haven't gone all in is like, I wouldn't, like, consider myself a Zelda fan. I don't hate Zelda. I like the property. I have surrounded myself with Zelda and Zelda fans and the series' games forever, but I've never beaten one, and I've never really gotten far in any of them. But I appreciate it, and that's the only reason I haven't gone deep
on buying this thing on launch just to play Zelda. But the preview coverage, whether you're a Zelda fan or not, what the preview coverage shows is that this is an open world game that it is going to satiate that what sort I'm looking for. It's going to satiate that thirst for an open world game that you get to explore again instead of
that isn't a Ubisoft.
Yes, open world game. Be guided along. So that's exciting for me because my very first open world game I've ever played was Morrowind, and there is no hand holding in that game at all. Yeah, who is Boogroll? I hope Boogroll's in Breath of the Wild.
My horse will be called Boogroll.
Yes,
I'll probably, I can say, "Where's Boogroll?"
I'll name my Link Boogroll.
And that's the question. I don't know whether you can name Link.
Interesting.
Because of the voice acting, and she's
that's
like,
"Wake true.
Up, Link.
That's true. Wake up, Boogroll."
It'd be now, amazing if she recorded like in Fallout 4, they recorded a ton of voices, and one of them was Boogroll.
Boogroll, big fan of my old Morrowind videos. But this Edge conclusion, this is mostly kind of hype for Zelda fans, more so than... I mean, I read it and I go, wow, you know, it's high praise. But I read this and I'm like, man, that's... like, especially from Edge, because they don't typically hand out 10s very often. Nines and 10s from Edge.
I think they average out at 1 10 per year. I think they've given out 19 in their history.
Yeah, the full list is on the internet somewhere all the games they've given 10. Some interesting games on that list, by the way. Rock Band 3. I mean, it's as perfect a Rock Band game as it gets. It was just odd seeing it like next to like Ocarina of Time and like
Mario Galaxy 2. Yeah.
But anyway, without further delay, this excerpt from the Edge review is, quote, "The result for all the longevity of its series and the familiarity of the open world genre is a game that evokes feelings we haven't felt for 20 years. Not since Ocarina of Time have we set foot in a world that feels so mind-bogglingly vast and unerringly magical, that proves so relentlessly intriguing. Plenty of games promise to let us go anywhere and do anything. Few, if any, ever deliver so irresistibly. 19 years on, Ocarina is still held up as the high watermark of gaming's best-loved and greatest series. Now, it may have to settle for second place." Ba-ba. End quote.
Mm. Yeah.
I'm hearing a lot of that. I'm hearing a lot of best Zelda ever. But I guess you kind of hear that when every Zelda game comes out, though. But this time I'm feeling...
I don't think we haven't really heard it about Skyward Sword, you know.
They did give that a 10.
They did give that a 10, which is interesting.
Now
I think if you ignore the motion controls, it probably could have been a 10. I would probably settle for like a high 8, though.
Now, I can't comment on any of that stuff because I have not played that or any. I haven't played any Zelda beyond Ocarina of Time past the Fire Temple. No, not true. Somewhere in my house is an old N64 cartridge with a Link named Blink because my name starts with a B, so I put a B in front of Link. And I am currently stuck in a water temple somewhere. That cartridge is in this house somewhere.
Yeah.
But so that's as far as I've ever played a Zelda game.
That's the best news I've heard is because Onuma's not involved in dungeon design, the water temple, if there is one, will not be a bitch.
Nice. Praise be.
Though in regards to the preview thing, the 5-hour limit is an interesting one because it is an open world game.
Yeah.
I guess that they know that within 5 hours you can't get to a dungeon or any significant story beats, but you can definitely finish the shrines, get the paraglider, and blitz it to Hyrule Castle and try to take on Ganon with a stick.
Yeah, I heard about that, about how it really is possible. If you wanted to rush to the last boss, you can do that.
He didn't get very far, and thus abandoned that plan.
I cannot wait. I kind of want to try it.
Yeah, the but first that's time. It's just like I'm going.
It's very reminiscent of like the Dark Souls runs where people stay at level 3 and just use their fists and they're naked the whole time just to see if they could beat the whole game like that. Like rushing right to Ganon as old Hour One link with a stick sounds like something that is going to be on YouTube in completion by April.
Within 2 days.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm giving them too little credit. Yes, within 2 days, not by April. Yeah. Really exciting stuff. I'm bummed out that I won't be joining in on that fun when it comes out, but I'm like super excited that these previews have been so glowing. Just for those that are buying it, like friends of mine who are buying the Switch, like you guys and some of my friends here in town, who have not shown a little, like, not shown apprehension about pre-ordering it, but just kind of, you know, that whole conversation about the launch and the online services and like there, and then with the Joy-Con thing, the disconnect thing when you're at a certain distance, whatever, like, but these previews just made all of that irrelevant really for anybody who pre-ordered this thing. Cause I mean, anybody who's pre-ordering the Switch, to get it on launch day is going to play Zelda. So like, it kind of doesn't matter anymore. Any complaints anybody had doesn't really matter. So I'm really excited for everyone who's getting it.
It's kind of unfortunate. I've just looked, and because of our new recording schedule, the global test fire is actually the week after our next recording. We'll have to wait till the April episode.
See that? To talk
about Splatoon.
I look forward to hearing about it. You guys will have to be. I'm gonna have to live vicariously through. Well, that's not true. I have friends and family here who are going to be owning a Switch, so I could probably go to their house. Okay,
that's what you do.
There
get
we go
to bring it over.
That's the power of this thing, huh? Come to my house and we, oh man, so I will be joining you guys for the test fire. Fucking
all nice.
All right, that's cool. The other thing I've noticed popping up on the internet since these previews went live is, and it's bumming me out because this year has been insane for video games. Like, absolutely. You can't keep up time wise. You can't keep up financially. The games just keep coming out, and like,
not at all.
They're not slowing down. Like, they're not. Like, Zelda, like, isn't the end of it. Like, there's Mass Effect. Then there's Persona. It doesn't end. It's not gonna stop. So, like, it can be stressful to keep up, but mostly it's exciting because there really is something releasing for everybody in these first few months. Like, if you like open world games, cool. If you like JRPGs, cool. If you like shooters, awesome. If you like fighting games, really great. Well, it's really bumming me out
if Prey turns out pretty good.
Yes, which I hope it does. I think it will. Arcane's pretty good. I forgot about Prey. Nice.
See, this episode's going to be a little bit weird, and we should explain that Evie's not here because of Switch saving. Neither her nor myself have played all that much. I've played a bit more than her. Bill has played a crap ton. A
lot of games.
But she'll be back next time.
Or will she? That was ominous.
Well, that's a good point, because Zelda will be about.
Exactly.
We might lose her forever. Yeah.
But what was really bumming me out after these Zelda previews came out, there began. I mean, this was inevitable. This is going to be inevitable because it's just, I guess, some people still operate this way. A lot of like fights between like Horizon versus Zelda, because I guess for some reason they're the same game. I mean, they're both open world games. They're both exclusive to their respective platform. They both have a bow and arrow. But other than that, like, both games are trying to achieve something.
Oh, they both have giant robots.
That's true. That's very true. They're trying to achieve, and you could tame stuff in the wild and ride it, and craft things. And but I see a lot of people like, oh, after I played Zelda, Horizon sucks, or look at Zelda's graphics compared to Horizon, or, you know, just the dumbest, most pointless. Like,
it's the
debates.
Same that it's been since, like, the 360.
Yeah.
I mean, it was probably the same in the old Nintendo Sega days, but there was no internet to really make it obvious.
It was just people fighting out in the streets. Well, mine goes fast! Oh, yeah, well, mine eats mushrooms and he's fat.
It's got dinosaur as a friend.
It's bumming me out, though, because, like,
This is like, if you like these kinds of games, the fact that there's Horizon and then a few days later you get to jump into Zelda, like, that's cool. Like, that should be like, now I know it's hard to celebrate it financially, like, or
that
time-wise.
Is possibly like the worst decision. I don't know who decided, like, who knew in Sony or in Nintendo what the dates were, but someone cocked up, because you don't really want to release two open world games 2 days apart from each other and being like super hyped for both of them.
I would say like Horizon's date was set, and then nobody knew Zelda's date until that presentation where nobody knew what was going on exactly. So it was just kind of an unfortunate case. But instead of it being a Battleborn and Overwatch situation, both of these games are going to sell extremely well, and they're both going to review really well. Well, Horizon's reviews already came out. It's just a bummer to me to see that happen. Like, for example, there was a quote from one of the previews, Metro. Metro.co.uk, their preview for Zelda had a quote in it that was like, oh, after playing this, I couldn't help but think of Horizon and how simple it feels after playing Zelda. And as soon as that quote was pulled from that article, you can go to the comment sections on YouTube, on Reddit, on Gaff, wherever, and it's like, see, look, Horizon sucks. And it's like, no, Zelda just has a more interactive open world, whereas Horizon's more story-based, and that's fine. That's okay, because you could play both, and then you're not playing the same game back-to-back. I think that's fine. I think that's great.
Like I say, neither of them seem an obvious like Ubisoft clone. You could go from playing Assassin's Creed to Watch Dogs to Far Cry, and you'd pretty much get the same experience in all of them, which I think is why people started to get burned out and were like, oh no, Zelda's open world. Whereas these are two completely different experiences, obviously made by two different studios.
It's exciting.
Each doing their own thing. I will pick up Horizon at some point. Unfortunately, the next 9 months are looking pretty expensive for me on the Switch.
Yeah, it's crazy. It's crazy. Maybe that's why some people fight so incessantly about their games, is that like they need a way to not feel envious that like somebody else is playing this game when they're not. Like, if I wanted to, I can go on the internet right now, because I am envious that I'm not going to be playing Zelda on launch. But it's something I'm going to patiently wait for, just for. I do have the money, for financial reasons, and because I have other stuff I want to play, and like reasons beyond like whatever. But I am envious that I'm not gonna get to play it on launch. So like, if I had that mentality of trying to justify or like to try to make myself feel better by not being able to play it, I would maybe go online and try to make Zelda look worse in front of all the fans. Like, every time you or Abby would tweet about it, I would respond with like Horizon GIFs and be like, "Yeah, look at this," like some kind of prick, like. Yeah. Like what you see in the comments, but in reality, it's like, man, both these games look so goddamn good, and I can't wait to eventually play Zelda. I'm so excited for that. Maybe that's part of it. And I think it's always kind of been the fanboy war thing. Like, people would rip on the PlayStation 3 for whatever reasons, mostly because they couldn't play Last of Us or Uncharted or whatever exclusives PS3 had, and Sony fanboys would rip on Xbox Live's paid service when they got free online, but in reality, PSN has sucked since the dawn of time. So it just never stops rolling, but it kind of bums me out when, like you see it in this way about two great games. But inevitability and all that.
Yep.
I'm excited to play both of them. So what are your opinions on what you've seen about Zelda so far? Before we get into
what
we've
been
playing...
Did you not listen to the Switch episode?
A little bit. You actually played it, huh?
Yeah.
That's right.
If you've not watched it, Abby, Andy, and I did on our Switch experiences. Abby got a lot more time playing Zelda than we did because she cheated the system. I wasted my opportunity, Bill.
Oh no!
Wasted it.
What happened? Oh, you go in depth with that in the Switch episode.
I can give you the summary. Okay. We were given a 10-minute demo, and I chose to use my time talking to the old man instead of exploring.
You went with what you would do at home. It's hard to break your own habits.
It was still great though. I'm worried about how much I'm going to lose track of time, because those 10 minutes flew by.
Yeah.
Abby got like half an hour total, I think. 25 minutes or so.
Nice.
So
is it? It's the same area that's in the preview events, I mm-hmm. assume. The what is it called? Yep. The something plateau. The Great Plateau.
Yes. Yeah.
Everything. Great.
Snipperclips is a launch title now.
Oh yeah, and there's going to be a demo as well. Yeah. That's cool. Yep. That's smart. Because I'm sure they know they have a really like hooky game there that like is gonna sell the idea of bringing that and popping those Joy-Cons off and playing together, and a demo is so smart for that. I think there should be a demo for 1-2 Switch as well, honestly. Just to put demos out there, you know? Does no harm, you know? Put a 1-2 Switch demo with like two games in there. Put the Quick Draw game and whatever.
Maybe one of the ones that shows off HD Rumble.
Yeah, yeah. But a demo for Snipper Clippers is great, because was it Snipper Clippers or Fast RMX? It's going to be $20.
Both of them.
Both? Nice. That's perfect. That is perfect.
Friday, I've had to work out a week-by-week plan, because I want to buy Shovel Knight, Fast RMX, Snipper Clips, I Am Setsuna, there was something else that I want to pick up in the first month, and I'm like, God damn, that's at least $100 that I'm going to be spending in the first month on eShop games.
I like that price.
I don't, because like I need to be saving money. But yeah, I need to work out when I'm buying what. I'm definitely buying Snipper Clips on Friday.
Yeah, game looks really great.
I came into this episode thinking I won't talk too much about the Switch, and we've been going for about 20 minutes on the
That's
Switch.
Fine, that's fine. They dropped a megaton of Zelda stuff on us yesterday. I felt it was worth talking about at least a little bit before it comes out. I won't keep us too long on Zelda. Actually, we'll probably cut it there just because Abby and yourself will have the game pretty soon, and you'll be able to give us more hands-on information on systems that were beyond the embargo that I don't mind hearing about, honestly. But yeah, I think I was reading one last tidbit on Zelda, which I thought was interesting. And actually, one thing in general that I think is really assuring about these previews is that, you know, they're only allowed to talk about certain areas or that first area, and they're only allowed to talk about the first 5 hours in this embargo. And what's really encouraging about that is most of the previews that I'm reading, and even some of the further impressions, or some of them have pushed it a little further by like kind of referencing some of the stuff they've been doing. Because these guys I've been playing the game for a few days now, like beyond that initial 5 hours, is one of them I saw that they didn't go to the first temple until they were 25 hours in, not because the temple was 25 hours in, but because like the what they've been given in that first area and the bits surrounding it, like stuff that's not even substantial story content, is so fun, and like that's all that's in these previews, that's all they're allowed to talk about. And so hearing the praise about just that alone, and not any of the story content and not certain main features, is really encouraging, because what the hell are these opinions going to look like when they're allowed to talk about everything else beyond just, oh, you can explore and get struck by lightning and NPCs have
a schedule. I would
hate
to have to review this game properly.
Oh, God. Nightmare.
Because I'd be torn between wanting to play it properly and playing at my own pace. I'm like, those two don't line up.
I was listening, this is a kind of a jumping off point. Just onto an aside here, I was listening to Easy Allies, one of the YouTube channel that does video game stuff. They're the X Game Trailers guys. I was listening to Ben Moore of Easy Allies talk about reviewing games, and I was listening to him talk about this because, like, for my entire life, it always kind of sounded attractive. Like, man, I could work in games media and I could review games, and this would be so great. I get to play all these games for free. Listening to him talk about like his process of playing games before and after becoming a journalist, Sounds like hell.
Yeah.
Like, where prior he would be able to focus on one game and really soak it in, and then currently, as we speak recording this, he has like 3 or 4 games that he's working on for review, and he has to meet deadlines for them, and like nah, I would not want to do that. That would, especially
you'd have to go for, you'd have to go from playing games to playing games.
Yeah, yeah, yep. And all while trying to formulate thoughts on it, like like not long. Like sometimes I finish a game and I'm just like, damn, that was good. And then I just, my brain's mush after that. Like I can't.
Yeah.
Like I'll just tweet something and that's all I could muster. I can't imagine having to like do Zelda or like a Horizon or a Mass Effect or like a Final Fantasy game and like really give a good review on it, because you can give a review on it and it could be a pretty shit review, like if it just passes deadline. Some reviews are like 3 paragraphs long. It's like, what the hell did you play?
Yeah,
I mean, granted, they probably did play it. It's just, you know, whatever. But interesting process. I'm glad I'm not a part of that.
Whilst I remember, did you? I haven't. I think yours is the only opinion I've not heard in regards to the season pass or the expansion pass for Zelda.
Okay, yeah, that's
it's been
point.
A point of contention in this household. And I'm curious on your thoughts.
I don't really see an issue with it. The only things that baffle me, the only things that maybe I would do differently, is include something that's not the Switch shirt. Like I get that they wanted to put a bonus in there if you buy it now. But this, I think the Switch shirt's kind of lame, personally. It's kind of weird running around Hyrule wearing a Switch shirt.
What is it in the Wii U version?
That's yeah, right? Buy a Switch is what they're saying the entire time you're wearing it. It's, like, it's an advertisement for the upgrade. But other than that, honestly, I mean, like, some people are mad that you can't buy the 2 packs separately. Like, if I don't want this first pack and I just want the bigger pack, I know I got to buy the... But, like, all things considered, $20 for everything really isn't that bad. So I mean, I look at it as, like, if the game is as incredible as it is with these previews... I mean, a lot of the outrage came before the previews came out. So, like, in terms of knowing how good the game was... you know, it was still on the table. So some like speculation of like, you know, what is the DLC gonna be? Because obviously there's no real details in there.
I think that's the biggest problem, and is probably the main reason why I'm of a certain point of view and Andy's on of another. I think that they've cocked up by saying new hard mode, because it implies that hard mode in itself is completely ripped out of the game and is being sold, whereas I am of the opinion that, like the new 3DS, it means that there is still the old version of hard mode in the game in some form, or there is a hard mode, but then this is something even harder.
Yeah. Well,
but they haven't explained it, and they didn't explain what the new map feature is. And it's like, there's a new map feature. It's like, okay, what is that? Is that like a water fountain that we get to go to, or is it a new island? Is there an island off to the east or whatever that we can go visit?
I guess I should probably clarify. Like, price-wise, I'm fine with it. And, like, the business model, I'm fine with it. The communication side of it is the side that, yeah, like, I...
And they were doing so well with Switch communication. It's just like, oh.
Did they need to announce it now is my question.
I think
wait when the game's in people's hands and everybody loves it, and then like, hey, you're loving Breath of the Wild? Well, good news, we're working on new stuff for it. And if you buy it now, you can get these bonus items. And then like, if I were to rewind time, I would go to the meeting where they picked the Switch shirt and have them pick something else.
Oh, you shit.
Yeah.
I'm holding off my disappointment and ire until they explain things better. On Friday when I boot up the game and I see that there is no hard mode and it's been cut out, then I'll be like, okay, that
is
a dick move.
From what I'm hearing from the previews, the game is pretty hard.
It's pretty hard.
And
the fact that there's... Because this is why I think that they've had to like overhaul hard mode. Hard mode traditionally is no hearts drop. and enemies do extra damage. Okay. Now, in Breath of the Wild, there are no wild hearts. You get your hearts back by eating. And the mechanic for expanding your heart slots has been sort of revealed from the 5-hour preview. I don't know if you know it.
Yes, I do.
I don't know whether it counts as a spoiler for yeah, Evie, I mean, so I'm going to say...
Should I say it? Should I just rip the Band-Aid off?
Yeah, you do it.
I think... I'm pretty sure I read what it is. Is that when you complete shrines? Is that how you do it? Or is that your stamina?
Pretty much, yeah. So,
yeah,
for every 4 shrines... Because we were always wondering what the soul orbs were for or whatever. For every 4 you get, you can either improve your stamina or your heart meter.
Mm-hmm.
Which means that because there's just over 100 shrines, so you get to level up 25 times.
I want to say this.
What does a 25 stamina Link look like?
And then...
just runs forever.
I want to say, when I originally heard that there were going to be like 100 shrines, my brain initially went, and I promise we'll get off Zelda in a few minutes. when I initially heard that there would be 100 shrines, my like brain was like, oh, they're probably like these unsubstantial, like little challenge things that you do. From everything I've heard from the previews and seen from footage, they're like really fun puzzle dungeons that,
yeah,
like, and the fact that there's that many of them, and that there's probably a pretty substantiated amount of thought put in each one, that's really impressive to me. And really, what's the word I'm looking for? Good. That's it.
What a word to try and remember. Good.
What's that word for things that aren't bad? But yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's cool. I like that. A lot of neat things in that game, and I'm looking forward to hearing you two talk about it. I'll be listening with. I will probably get some hands on with it as well. I will have hands on with it on Saturday night, with our my cousin that I play D&D with is getting it, so it'll be at the D&D session. So we're gonna.
No one's playing D&D.
Yeah, it'll be Zelda all night most likely. So I will get to see it in person. So when we do all get to talk about it, I'll be able to give some thoughts on it, and maybe I'll convince him to grab 1-2 Switch, and you know I'll have some Switch thoughts, you know, and on some games besides just Zelda. But yeah, exciting stuff ahead. I'm excited for all of you guys, genuinely.
I'm terrified.
it's crazy times.
It really is.
So, is there anything you wanted to talk about before we get into what we've been playing? Anything in the news? Any aching stories?
I swear that there has been stuff. I thought that if we did it monthly, more regular, I'd be able to keep track of what's been going on.
Yeah. Well, there's definitely been stuff. I just don't.
There's
keep
been
track.
A lot of stuff. I've just been so exhausted.
For sure. Yeah.
it's sort of going in one ear out the other.
Your payoff is coming soon.
Oh my god.
I'm looking here. I'm trying to see if there's anything that happened within the last 2 days that is, and nah.
I suppose that we may as well, whilst we are talking about Zelda, and then we can get it over and done with. I did ask the audience if they had any questions, and Robble asked, how do you endure the wait for Breath of the Wild? I can't speak for Ebby because she's not here. You're enduring it by living vicariously through others.
Yeah.
I've actually, because of my exhaustion, I've made it somewhat worse for myself because I'm always tired, and when I'm tired, time drags so long. So coming home of an afternoon is just like, Is it nighttime yet? Is it nighttime yet? No, it's only 3:00. What about? Oh, it's only 3:10. So I'm not doing too good at that, and so the response is, I fall asleep in the afternoon, have a nap. I listen to a lot of people playing the trailer music. So yeah, I'm just listening to a lot of music, trying to pass the time, just being idle, watching a lot of YouTube.
One more week.
5 more days. That's the other thing. I scour the internet for my daily picture to upload and tweet at 7 a.m.
Yes, the hype GMT.
Tomorrow's one is going to be pretty good. It'll be yesterday's one, relative to the
video. Liked the I was a big fan of the 3D printed
the fake one.
My
that
god
is possibly my most favorited tweet.
Yeah, big success.
Or not favorited, but it currently, for me, it's a lot. 79 retweets, 194 likes.
Yay! Kinross going viral.
compared to Ebby's one about FMA Nendoroids, and she's got like 2,000 retweets, and she's like, oh no.
I had a tweet get retweeted by Dodger once, and then I was in class. This was like 3 or 4 years ago. I had a tweet, and it got retweeted by Dodger. And I went on Twitter on the computer in the computer lab, just checking my, and I look up at the notifications thing, and I have like 500 notifications, and I'm like, what the fuck happened? Because I didn't know she had retweeted it. And I'm looking, and I'm like, how did this tweet spread? It's not even that good. And I'm like, and it was freaking me out. And I'm like, I turn over to my friend. I'm like, dude, what's happening to me? And I'm like, then I saw she retweeted it. It was all her. One time I tweeted something about zucchini bread that she retweeted as well. That also got, and I'm like, that's my only hopes for a viral tweet is that Dodger retweets it. So I just have to tweet Dodger bait and hope she retweets it. That's it. Like tweeting things such as Dodger retweet this.
Yep.
Maybe I'll try that later today.
100% of the time.
but yeah, I can't imagine I mean, I guess I can, because I've waited for things that I've been like insanely hyped for years. You know,
I still have not thought of something that I've been this excited for.
That's amazing. It's a great feeling to have. To
It's like a pit, a stone in your stomach. Just
the last time I was this excited for something like this, like to the point where I'm legitimately can't, because I've been excited for games for the last few years. Like I get excited for games all the time. Like, oh, I can't wait for Mass Effect or Uncharted or. You know, I get hyped.
Yeah, there's
for all
games
that
I look forward to.
But the last time I got like what you're experiencing right now is back when the DS was coming out. I had this manila folder, and I forget what grade I was in when the
Nintendo's.
DS came out. I had for the DS system itself. I made it was like a filing folder, and I got marker and I wrote DS on it. And I got all these game magazine subscriptions, and every time they had an article about the DS, I would cut it out and like tape it to the front. And any article about the DS, I would slip it in that folder. And then every night before bed, I would pull that folder out and just look through all my DS stuff and go, I can't wait to have a DS. Every night before, it put me to sleep like a baby's bottle. I even know that original DS is one of the ugliest pieces of hardware ever created by man.
It's really bad.
I'll get it at a cereal box, like a cereal box PDA. I was so excited for that. I'll never forget playing Metroid Prime Hunters on Christmas Day with a little thumb stylus. That was the last time I truly counted the days down for something like that. That's a good feeling to have, you know.
I guess last time I was this excited about something in general was when we went to Japan.
Oh yeah, I can imagine. I would be flipping out.
Based on the fact that I had a countdown and still do have a countdown, it's like 400 days ago, and I'm on my phone and I've got a countdown for the Switch as well. So
nice. Wait, so you went to Japan 400 days ago?
Let's have a look.
Time flies, dude.
It really. This year is going so quick. Come on.
I
departed for Japan 435
what
days
the
ago.
Fuck! Wow, almost a year. Yeah. Almost a year and a half. That's scary.
The Switch is out in 6 days. Conversely,
that is also scary. But yeah, no, that's super exciting. I can't wait till the thing's out, like in people's hands. And
I'm looking forward to the Switch being out so that we can stop talking. We're not going to stop talking about it. I am sorry if you're not interested in the Switch, audience.
I thought you were apologizing to me.
Well, I'm apologizing to you as well. We have talked. We had three videos dedicated to the Switch, each of them 2 hours long, near enough. I feel bad about it, but
I mean, it's some of the biggest news out, and this episode alone is dominated mostly by Zelda because of the previews, and there's really not a single set of eyes that aren't placed on those Zelda previews right now. So, I mean, if I mean, I've thought about it too, you know, the Miles Fish discussion, but at the same time, it's like, I don't have an issue with it. I don't have an issue doing it because it's the, out of this gen or whatever gen the Switch is part of, you know, Nintendo runs at their own beat anyway. I don't really think they're part of that whole, oh, it's the next gen. It's Nintendo. They do what they want. It's the only remaining like mystery out of any of the big three, you know, like it's the, like we all know what to expect out of Sony and Microsoft. We all know what to expect out of their, I mean, I'm not saying that we're all Nostradamus and like all their games are going to play, but I mean, I just mean as in like, this is a new piece of hardware from Nintendo and they have a lot of haters and a lot of fans and they make headlines and they always do something different. So there's always a lot to talk about when they release new hardware. So I will join Kinner Ross in apologizing, but at the same time, I don't.
On the bright side, come mid-April, I'll be able to afford games that are on other systems or on the PC, so I'll be playing more things and so I could talk about.
That's
not just
that's why
stuff.
I exist. As well. I don't play as much Nintendo stuff, and I'm actually glad you guys play so much Nintendo stuff, though. Honestly, people listening at home, this is a real behind the scenes moment, because I don't get to play as much of it, and I won't own a Switch for a little while. So like, I'm glad, you and Abby do, because I play a lot of stuff that you guys just aren't interested in. And I think that balances out quite well. So that's why our episodes are 3 hours long. That's good. That's a good thing. You get a lot of different spectrums because a lot of people like to shit on Nintendo. A lot of podcasts shit on Nintendo. A lot of outlets maybe don't have as many Nintendo fans as others do, and then like luckily you have places like Game Explain that cover Nintendo in depth quite often, and Easy Allies gives Nintendo a pretty fair shake as well, but a lot of them are usually pretty cynical about Nintendo and like it's kind of tiring, so it's nice to cover all bases, even if it seems like recently all we talk about is a Switch. It's because it's the biggest thing to talk about recently. As the year goes on, there's so many games coming out that it'll even itself out. But yeah, cool.
So what have you been playing, Bill?
Well, I was trying to figure out which one I should talk about first. I was saying to myself this morning that I'm not going to go in depth on all of these, but I probably will.
Just for the sake
of doing it.
That's why it's a somewhat advantage that Abby isn't here. Because it's pretty much the You Show with a bit aside from me.
Yakuza 0 is the one that I'm currently. I have my little like to do list that I'm trying to wade through right now. Like Horizon delivers here on Monday, and I want to beat Yakuza 0 before I can play that. Now I'm in the middle of Neo. But Neo is a game that I will play for like 100 hours, so that's not like a I gotta beat Neo before I move on type of situation. Neo is that game that will always be there in the background as I move up from story to story game, because I don't pay attention to the story in Neo; it's nonsense. And people will crucify me for this, but it's you don't have to pay attention to the story in Neo the same way you don't have to pay attention to the story in say Bloodborne or Souls. You know, it's just kind of you can just finely tune in on the gameplay, but So I've been playing Yakuza 0. Have you ever played any of the Yakuza games, Kinneros?
I have not, but I think an episode or two ago we were talking about how I'd been interested in the idea but didn't know where to start.
Okay.
And you said that Yakuza 0 was probably a great place and because they're doing a remake of one later in the year, I think, aren't they?
Perfect place. Have I talked about this game, like about me playing it on a past episode?
I don't
remember.
I think that you were just talking about things you were looking forward
to. Ah, that makes sense.
Yeah, because it was in the Game of the Year episode where we were talking about games that you were looking forward to this year.
Yes.
And you mentioned Yakuza 0.
So, in terms of it being the perfect starting point, for anybody listening and for you, Kinross, Yakuza 0 is probably... It's a series that... it doesn't sell too hot in the West. Typically, I'm going to go ahead and assume, well, one, put it on marketing. Two... It's one of those series that has been following the same protagonist since the PlayStation 2. So, like, when a numbered Yakuza game comes out, namely, like, oh, Yakuza 5, it might be like, you know, even if people say, yes, you can start with this one, it might be a situation of people sitting there going like, but do I really want to? Because, you know, like, so I'm not going to buy that. You know, it's five games in. It's the same protagonist since 2006. Like, I don't need.
So,
don't,
so it's like the same thing. It's the same thing of it's a bit weird to jump in at Uncharted 4.
Sort of. Each Yakuza game has its own self-contained story, but it continues from the past game. So like relationships and like allegiances and like the chain of command within the Yakuza kind of carries over from game to game. But like my first Yakuza game was Yakuza 3, and on the disc for Yakuza 3 and on the disc for Yakuza 4 and for Yakuza 5, they have really extensive like recap cutscene movies that kind of recaps like the entirety of Yakuza 1 and 2. If you,
oh, that's good.
If you bought 4, it recaps all of 1, 2, and 3, and 5, obviously, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So, like, they really ease you in if you want to. It's not that hard if you want to start with a newer entry. But with Yakuza 0, it's pretty much the perfect spot, and it's selling much better than previous entries in the West. It's being marketed much better than previous entries in the West. It has been reviewed more times than any previous entry in the West. There's a lot of really great buzz around Zero, and it's really exciting because it's a really great series. And Yakuza Zero is probably one of like my favorite games that I've ever played. And that's like not hyperbole because I'm playing it now or whatever. But these games, I'm really glad more people are getting a look at them through like through Zero's launch, because like what's in these games is like. Yakuza 0, I'm not going to talk about the series as a whole. I'm going to trim it down to just Yakuza 0. It's one of those rare games where, like, every minute that I'm playing this, like, I'm never having a bad time. I'm always having fun playing Yakuza 0. There's never a task. There's never a side quest. There's never a moment where I'm going, ugh, like, ever. And, like, I'm trying to understand how it's possible in a game, because games that I would give 10s, have moments in them that I go, ugh. So as I'm playing Yakuza 0, moment to moment, story beat to story beat, side quest to side quest, minigame to minigame, every single second, like the hours fly by playing it, because like, every single second is full of something just insanely fun, funny, sad, tense, emotional, fun. Like, I don't understand how they make these games so good. Like, I don't get it.
The gameplay loop for Yakuza, is it sort of I get the impression it's sort of a shooty beat 'em up RPG type thing.
It is. It's one of the more.
I might be thinking of Red Steel.
It's one of the more unique like RPGs out there. Like, there's not many. A lot of people liken it to Shenmue, in some ways like a successor to Shenmue, because you're walking around a somewhat open world subsection of Tokyo, and you are taking on side quests and talking to weird people and fighting. There are guns and there are weapons, but you don't really use them too often. It's mostly like beat 'em up combat. Like, when you encounter like bad guys to fight, it zones in to like a little arena, like it cuts off a section of the street, and it's really like arcadey beat 'em up style, like moves and combos, and
so sort of like Sleeping Dogs.
Yes, in a way.
Okay.
And the like gameplay loop is pretty much what you'd expect out of most like open world games. You have like your main quest marked on your map, and you have things to do around the city. And what I appreciate about Yakuza's version of open world, and I think it's why the gameplay loop is always fun minute to minute to minute, is that clutter your map with shit. Like, they never do it, ever. The only things, when you open the map, the only things on there are your main quest point and building locations. Like, for anyone listening, we just had a hiccup. I mean, it will be edited around, but at this point, you will have known that I didn't finish my sentence properly. The gameplay loop. So on the map for your city is your main quest icon, and then just points of like places of interest, whether it be a bar, a convenience store, a disco club, an arcade, a softcore porn store, a casino, whatever. Just places you can go to do mini games.
And typically what you'll do is you'll get your main quest. You will open your map, choose to either go do that main quest or, you know, get distracted by one of the mini games that's on your map, whether it be the arcade, batting cages, disco, karaoke, whatever it may be. And then typically in the process of doing that, the way the game handles the side quests is they're never marked on your map, so you never know where to find them, but they are always, you come upon them randomly. They aren't randomly placed, but let's say at the corner of the one street during the daytime, there will be a couple fighting there. And so if you run upon that corner during the daytime, you will trigger that side quest. Whereas if you run by at night, you might not. Or if you never run by that corner at all, you'll just never get that side quest. It doesn't go away. You just will never get it. So a lot of the side quests just kind of happen organically as you're exploring the city, opposed to like, oh, there's a whole bunch of side quests up in this corner. Let me go collect them all and do them. It just kind of feels natural as you're walking about the city. You might notice something weird, and your character just kind of can't help but get involved. Or you could typically say no as well if you don't want to help.
It sounds kind of Majora's Mask-y.
Yeah, I like that system a lot. Mm. Like one of the reasons it's so just effortlessly fun is that you never feel like you're doing something out of obligation. You're doing it because you want to. Yeah, you're placed into this situation, and it's intriguing enough that you want to keep going. It isn't like, oh, I wonder how many frogs I got to get now. And it's an interesting contrast because as much as I love Final Fantasy XV, I started playing Yakuza like right after I was in the middle of Final Fantasy XV. I was kind of playing them side by side, and like the side quest structure couldn't be any more different. Like it's jarring in a fun factor kind of way. Now, both types of side quests serve their purpose.
Yeah.
Whereas Yakuza's, you're not really getting experience from them. You're fighting things in them, but they're mostly there for the story, whereas Final Fantasies are experience, you know, mm-hmm. mostly. They're filler quests to get XP. But my favorite thing about Yakuza, and like, whereas that gameplay loop might seem like, oh, you know, you're doing side quests, doing main missions, you're bowling, whatever. The writing in these games and the characters are, like, so above so many things I play regularly that, like, It like I said earlier, it makes me so happy that Zero's getting so much exposure, and it's getting a lot of exposure on Twitter also because a lot of people are clipping out like their favorite moments, whether it be, I don't know if you've seen the scene, it was all over Twitter where you hire a chicken to work at your realtor's office.
Have you not seen
that clip?
I haven't seen anything of this actually.
That tweet went viral, and it got a lot of buzz around the game as well as with the positive marketing and reviews, and it, the game is full of just wacky moments, and it does such a great job at managing tone because its storyline is very serious, mm-hmm. and very tense and very gripping, and it's a really great crime drama, but then alongside that you have moments of just total comic relief and just that Japanese humor that you really only find in products of Japan. It, for example, I'm trying to think. I want to give an example of a side quest. Okay. Kind of not on the point of the zaniness, but kind of still on the point of the side quest and how it manages tone so well,
mm-hmm.
is every side quest is kind of there to take some pressure off from the main story in that every one of them's lighter in tone typically.
Yeah.
The main quest is like a blackmail story and very violent. It's very sad. It's very rugged. And so the game offsets that by throwing you in these situations like walking across a dominatrix out in the street saying goodbye to one of her customers. And as you overhear this conversation, this dominatrix is very bad at her job. She's too nice. And the customer, like, keeps going back to her because he likes her.
Yeah.
And he wants to see her get better. And you overhear that and you walk over and your character trains her to be a better dominatrix. And it's just so goofy and it's so just odd. And it's handled so well. And it has like a really happy ending and like it's really touching. And one of my
biggest compliments towards this game is every single side quest ends in, like, making somebody's life, like, significantly better. Mm-hmm. Like, there's never a side quest that ends poorly or that ends in a way that makes you feel like it either wasn't worth it or that you did something wrong. Yep. And I think they do it on purpose because you are technically a bad guy, like in the mafia and on
yeah.
and doing crime. Like your character necessarily isn't like a terrible, he doesn't do things he shouldn't do, like he doesn't kill innocent people or anything like that, but you are technically doing things you shouldn't be doing.
Yeah, yeah.
Throughout the main plot. So they have you do these things that are just so out of character and ridiculous. Because the two mains, you play as two characters in Yakuza 0, Kazuma Kiryu and Goro Majima. They are so, like, deadpan and straight-faced that there are side quests where you're standing outside a burger place and you overhear these production assistants for a commercial shoot say how their producer just didn't show up to the shoot and they need somebody who is intimidating to stand in for him because the director is kind of a dick. So you catch their eye and they ask you if you could fill in as a producer. So they dress you up in like a fancy pink sweater with like a cardigan on
mm-hmm.
and they have you stand in as the producer. So the way they have you interact with this quest then is because your character has no idea at all about television lingo or how these things operate. They have you perform like little tasks around the set of the commercial.
Yeah.
By using television lingo, and you have to try to guess what these words mean as the player. So, like, one of the commands was to clean up the food off the table. It was a commercial for a restaurant, and I don't remember the exact lingo, so I'm not going to try to word it in the way that the game did. But, like, you start to just not understand what they're saying at all, and you're just messing up a lot. And the entire situation is just incredibly fish out of water and goofy.
Mm-hmm.
Like right off of a scene where you are now wanted for the murder of somebody you didn't kill. It's just totally ridiculous. But it does it in a way that's really endearing. And in terms of, like, talking any further on it, I haven't beaten the game yet. I have about 25 hours in currently. Mm-hmm. I'm on chapter, like, 4 of, like, 15. So, like,
Jesus.
Yeah. It's easy to get distracted.
Yeah.
But my two favorite side quests in this game, and it's why every time one pops up, because usually you'll encounter the side quest when you're running to, like, your next main objective. Like, you come upon them randomly, so they kind of pepper them everywhere. So it's a pretty good, like, 80% chance when you're running to your next objective that you're going to come upon one of these, and you have the option to either deny it or accept it. There's no, like, let me add it to my quest log and do it later. You just kind of say yes or no.
Mm-hmm.
And every time I come upon one, I never get mad or, like, go, ugh. Like, even if I'm dead set on, like, I'm going to beat this main story mission and turn the game off, they always hook me in. And it was because the first one that I did, something about it just made me so happy. There's this a corner store, and it's nighttime, and you see a line of people lined up, like, out the door.
Yeah.
And you go up and you ask the little kid in the back of the line, you know, what is this line for? It's huge. And he tells you it's for a sequel to an RPG series that is in very short supply. And he was told if he gets in this line, we're in his position, he's guaranteed a copy. And he's so excited. He saved up all this money. He can't wait to play it with his dad, blah, blah, blah. So, you know, you wish the kid well. You tell him. For people listening, I'm going to spoil the outcome of the side quest if anyone cares. Sorry. So you tell him, oh, you wish him luck. You hope he gets it, blah, blah, blah. You walk away. You make your peace. You walk by that same store like an hour later, and the kid is sitting outside crying. And you go up and you talk to him, and the kid tells you that somebody came up and stole his game. And being the badass that you are, you promise the kid you'll get his game back. So you chase down the thief who stole his game, and right as you get to that thief, someone is stealing the game from him. And you go up and talk to the original thief and go, like, what happened? Why would you steal that kid's game? And he tells you a story about how, you know, that guy stole it, blah, 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 go get him. And you're like, okay, well, fuck it. I can't deal with you right now. I have to go get the game from that guy. So you run after that guy, and as you get to him, someone steals the game from him. So then it's taken by, like, a really badass looking, like, Yakuza guy, and you finally make it to that guy, and he's standing there with the copy of the game, and you start talking to him and telling him that, hey, man, like, you didn't steal that game from an adult. That game belongs to a little boy. And he, like, threatens you, and he's like, well, you're not getting it from me. I need this game. You don't understand. I need it. I need it. And the kid comes walking down the street after following you, chasing all of the thieves, and the guy, the final guy who stole the game, happens to be the kid's dad. And he, the father has just been split up with by the mother, and he wanted to try to prove that he's still a good dad by getting him this game. He promised his son he would get him this game no matter what, not knowing the kid had saved up this money to buy this game. So then they have this big touching conversation, blah, 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 about parenting and love, and there's a happy ending there. And like that entire sequence was like, was the first side quest I did in the game. And I'm like, oh, that was a really nice ending. This, my second favorite one I've done in the game so far. It's not really silly. It's not really like goofy in any way. The second character you play as, Goro Majima, he's missing an eye. He wears an eye patch. Just as context for that character's look. Ponytail, eye patch, mean looking. He sees a little girl outside of an arcade, and she's peering into the window looking at the crane machine. And you go up and talk to her, and she tells you that she has her eye on this stuffed animal. She wants it so bad, but she doesn't have any money to get it. And so you promise that, okay, I'll go in there and win it for you. So you win her that doll, you give it to her, she runs home. The next day, you see her there again, and she wants the next doll, and, you know, same situation. She starts wanting to call you dad and all this stuff, and your character is understandably like, okay, I'm weirded out by this, that's fucked up. I'm not your dad. So then you get her a toy a few more times, so she just kind of keeps showing up. The final day, she shows up with the one stuffed doll with, like, knife stabs in it, and it's all ripped and torn, and the fluff is all coming out. And you ask, like, what's going on? And she's crying and saying that there's these bad dudes right now fighting her mom. And so you follow her back to her home, and there's these loan shark guys like harassing the mother, trying to get a payment off of her that she had to take out to take care of her daughter because the dad is gone.
Yeah.
Dad died. And you show up, and you take care of that. You beat those guys up, whatever. You help that family out. And then the little girl is still sad because the doll is all, you know, cut up and everything. And she really liked that one because it was given to her by my new dad. And so she wants to get rid of it. But then you have this conversation about, because your character, Goro Majima, is kind of disfigured as well. And they have this really, like, long conversation about flaws and each one makes you special, and that there's nothing wrong with that stuffed animal at all, and blah, blah, blah. And it was just a really, really, like, out of nowhere moment in these side quests that you find that you never know where they're going to lead.
Mm-hmm.
Like, even the goofiest ones, like a man trying to propose to his girlfriend with a crossword puzzle that he made, and she doesn't want to solve the puzzle because it's too hard, but he can't tell her, like, why she needs to solve it, so you have to help her out with your crossword expertise to solve the puzzle.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, there's so many goofy little side quests that always end up ending in something that makes someone's life better. And I know I just ranted a really long time about that, but it's something I really appreciate about that game, and it makes doing every side quest worth it, because it's never just, like, go beat this guy's ass. Like, it always ends in a really, and I think it's really fun that you are a hardened criminal doing these things for everyday humans. I think it offsets the bad things you do in the story, and it's really, really a fun game. I really, really like Yakuza 0. The main story is incredible. It's some of the best storytelling. I love it. It's so good. Such a good game.
The organic nature of the side quests sounds interesting, but I have to wonder, like, when you see a question mark on a map and you know how many side quests there are, then you can be like, okay, I actually want to pace these out so that by the end game I still have a couple to do. I wonder how easy it is in that game to just be so engrossed in helping people out that you actually, before you're even like halfway through the game or whatever, you just run out of side quests. You just have ended up doing them all.
That isn't, yeah, it's an interesting question.
Or whether each chapter unlocks a new set of side quests.
That is what I'm thinking. I'm I'm not too like well versed in how the Yakuza games handle their like their rollout of these quests.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of wish Final Fantasy didn't give you certain quests until a certain point in the story, or they like they kind of, you know,
yeah,
drip fed them to you a little better. In terms of Yakuza, I'm not sure if I want to say it's probably on a chapter by chapter basis, whereas certain like side quests unlock on certain parts of the city. Mm-hmm. Because I'm almost positive there are times where I ran past a section of the town,
yep,
during the daytime and have not gotten something, and then later in the game ran past that same section at the same time of day and triggered an event.
Okay.
For a side quest. So I want to say they probably roll them out. So for example, I'm 25 hours into the game. There's a counter. It tells you how many sub-stories you've completed for each character. I have done 10 side quests on the one character and 11 on the other.
Mm-hmm.
And the first character has about 70, and the second character has about 60, I believe.
Okay.
Around that number. So I want to say that they are drip-feeding them in a way that unlocks by chapter, but it's definitely a concern where it's like, you know, if they're popping so often as you're running from objective to objective, you know, it would be a bummer to totally drain the game of those, because they're just as entertaining as the main story, and then have nothing left. Because when you do beat the game, you do unlock like a free mode kind of thing that lets you go and do all the mm-hmm. side quests, but like it lets you do it in a way that the main story doesn't let you play with the game. Like, for example, after you beat the game, you get to change outfits, whereas yeah. throughout the duration of the main game, you don't get to do that. So yeah, it would be a bummer to drain them all before you finish the game, since you do unlock more stuff afterwards. But I assume they probably handle it in that way, where it's chapter by chapter. Yeah. Different ones pop up to pace the game. But yeah, it's just a deliciously fun game. Every minute's just a blast. It's worth checking out.
I think
for anyone who's it's the perfect place to start, for sure.
Okay.
Sorry, what were you gonna
say? I was gonna say I can't remember whether this is for Yakuza 0, but a complaint that I've heard is that there are some elements of the game that are super super weeby Japanese, that might be off-putting to the general consumer. And I think it was something about idols or whatever, but that might have been in one of the previous games.
There is. Okay, so to go into detail on some of the side activity in the game, like besides just the side quests, like the game has some mini games that are pretty in depth. One of them, for example, the second character you play as, Goro Majima, runs a hostess club.
Oh, okay.
And that is a really frighteningly in depth simulation of running a hostess club, where you are recruiting women and leveling up their stats and customizing their outfits and their makeup and their personalities to better attract customers, and you're making money, and it's like a straight up, like somebody threw this on Steam for $4.99.
Yeah.
And that it's a little strange. I can see that being very strange for people who are not familiar with either hostess clubs or Japan at all, you know, mm-hmm. To where it's like, why am I doing this?
But that's side also stuff, so.
Yeah,
okay.
You don't have to, but it's a big part of that second character.
Yeah.
So whereas they kind of make you do it a little bit. Then there's the like Jav idols, like the porn stars,
mm-hmm.
Whose like cards you find on the street. It's one of the collectibles in the game, and for every one you find, you unlock a new video at the porn shop. Now, these videos are not pornographic in any way. You go in there, it's obvious what your character is about to do, and they show you like a 10-second clip of like a Japanese woman in her bikini, and it plays like cheesy music. But that's a little strange, because when you pick up that collectible, there's no warning what you're about to pick up. You pick up this card, and it has a picture of an idol, of a Jav idol on it, and she's in like scantily clad clothing, and like it's like, oh, okay. That's the collectible in this game. It's a little strange. You probably wouldn't find that in a Western open-world RPG.
Probably not, no.
But yeah, so there are definitely activities that are definitely very Japanese, like for sure. And Yakuza 3 came out in the West, it was a big surprise for people here, because the fate of the Yakuza games here were kind of undetermined
because they didn't sell too hot. Yakuza 1 and 2 on PS2 didn't sell too great. Yakuza 3 ended up going through some controversy during its localization process because they cut a lot of stuff that they deemed not culturally appropriate, like that the audiences might not get. I guess it was their way of trying to maybe streamline some of the crazier shit out of the game so that it maybe was more attractive to Western audiences.
Yeah.
But it was met with a lot of backlash, and they decided going forward with 4 and 5 and then 0 that they wouldn't cut any content going forward, that any weird stuff would just remain because that's the game's identity. But no, for sure, that is definitely a good part of the game's charm, but I can see why it would turn people off, because there are things in the game that are so overtly Japanese that it might not resonate with everybody, for sure.
Okay.
But yeah.
I will add it to my some point in the year list.
Yeah, it's a great place to start. It is 100% prequel before the first game.
Yep.
And then it ties right into the remake of the first game that is coming to the West in the summer.
Mm-hmm.
So it is as good a time as any to jump into the Yakuza games. And Yakuza 0 is probably the best one out there right now. So it's a really great entry to start. It doesn't date the past games. It's just the perfect version of the Yakuza games. It's just so good. So good. I don't want to rant any more about it. When I beat it, I will talk more about it.
Okay.
And give it a GODY award. maybe.
We're going to have to increase our GODYs based on the first 2 months.
Insane.
If you're going absolutely by even insane. The Edge reviews of stuff, there's like 10 nines, tens already.
It is absurd. And like, I am picking up Mass Effect. I'm picking up Horizon. I want to pick up Nier Automata. I have Gravity Rush 2 sitting here unopened.
Prey.
Fuck. Like, this is so many games. Splatoon Prey is 2. Coming out. I like, Jesus, Mary.
Mario Odyssey. This is, Fire Emblem
Red
Heroes.
Red Dead Redemption 2.
Red Dead Redemption 2.
Fire Emblem.
Ooh,
Destiny 2.
Yeah.
I can't take it. I can't take it. But Persona 5. Did you want to? I have some other games I've been playing, but I figure now's a good time to talk about Ghost Recon. We'll put that in the center here.
Okay. Have you played any of it?
I played the closed beta.
Okay.
I did not play the open beta, but I have played the closed beta.
Okay.
To the end.
So I have only played in the open beta. I've only played about 3 hours with Andy and Matt yesterday on his stream. I can't remember. Do you remember Rocket League, Bill?
The Vector Master that we played? Yes.
So you remember the sort of style of play that Andy goes for in that sort of game. We weren't massively productive for the first half of the stream. It was filled with accidental grenadings, accidental runnings over, crashing, barrel rolls. We were trying to do one of the supply drop missions because I was like, I'm going to specialize in being the revive guy because we're down a lot. So we're trying to grab this helicopter, and Andy decides that we're going to fly a plane over it, and he's going to parachute out onto the point to grab the helicopter and fly out. And what he actually does is just alert everyone in the base, because you're flying a goddamn plane over it, and they steal the helicopter. And he triumphantly says, "It's okay, I shot the pilot." But the helicopter came down, but hovered about 20 feet off the ground, so we couldn't get into it. So we had to blow it up and try again later. The second time we tried it, one of Matt's Uplay friends joined us. Not knowing Andy or myself at all, which we feel awful about, but we'd just all bought... Matt, Andy, and I had just bought parachute upgrades. And we hadn't told this other guy to buy them. And so we were going to parachute into the medical supply base. So we all jump out of the plane. And as I'm parachuting down, I notice that he's still in the plane as it explodes
because he couldn't jump out, and so I had to divert and revive him whilst Andy ran in, stole the helicopter, and got it away somehow.
It sounds like things went good.
It was that sort of thing where it's obviously incredibly frustrating when you're trying to do something, but it was so enjoyable as well, just trying to do things stealthy. Andy's not a stealthy person, despite what he may claim about Metal Gear being his favorite franchise.
I'm with you, Andy. I'm really bad at stealth in this game as well.
Well, no, he doesn't. Andy's version of stealth is, I will run in and shoot them in the face, and why have they seen me? or I will park a smoking car right in front of someone and be surprised when they start shooting me. He doesn't approach it stealthily at all. I kind of really want to play this game more. I was hoping to get some more time in earlier with Matt, but he wasn't available. I will probably pick it up in a sale. I won't pick it up at launch because it's relatively expensive. For what little experience I had with the AI is awful, so I would have to be playing with people. So it needs to be cheap enough for other people to want to buy it and for it not to be a massive money investment to not get any use out from me.
Yeah.
We're undecided as to whether we'd play with Andy again. we would probably play with him if we were wanting to just have a bit of fun and go crazy. Maybe not quite so much for story purposes.
Poor Andy.
you need to watch this stream. I'll link you to the VOD. It was...
Yes, I'll definitely check
that. One of the best moments, and unfortunately it's not on the stream because Matt and I split off separately because Andy was going berserk in a car with a machine gun on the back of it, was Matt was driving along in a tractor with the radio on, and I was sat on the back of the tractor, and we were just poodling along to the destination on the roads, following the speed limit, trying to overtake cars and not get wrecked. It was amazing.
It is a really, 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 really fun co-op game that I was genuinely surprised by.
Yes.
Like, it was one of those games where every time they would show it at E3, it was kind of like, okay, cool, whatever. You know, it's an Ubisoft open world game. They made Ghost Recon open world. You know, it's got a really large Smuggler's Run-like environment, and it's probably fun. But every time I would see E3 stuff for it, I was kind of tuned out. Like, all right, fine, whatever. This is Ghost Recon time. I'm going to go bathroom or whatever. But I got into the closed beta with some friends, and like we played all night and did everything in that closed beta. And I believe the open beta is some different stuff, so I need to download that and check it out.
I think it adds a new area. I think so. It's the closed beta stuff plus a new area.
Oh, cool.
I could be wrong.
It's just a blast. Like the amount of the different ways you can approach objectives, and I mean they always ended up devolving into the same thing because we just suck. It always ended up just like, all right, it's time to kill. Like it was never a successful stealth operation, but like just the amount of goofy things you can do, like hiding in the trunk and then popping the trunk open and just shooting, it looks so funny, and it's such a blast to discover stupid ways to do things.
I don't know.
Game really surprised me.
I don't know
really
if Andy's highlighted yet, but I was driving. Matt was in the boot, in full ghillie. He decided to travel in the trunk. He started climbing out. As he's halfway out of the car, we get rear-ended by Andy at high speed. Matt instantly dies, and the car catches fire, I think, and I explode. There's just so much weird... I don't like that you can't jump, I'll tell you that much. I kept hitting space to try and jump, and it just didn't do anything. I'm like, okay, remember space doesn't do anything. Could never remember. I find that the tutorial system is pretty, pretty bad. It took us a good while to work out how the skills system worked, how the upgrades for the weapons worked, and all that. And I don't know how to... When I open up my skills, it always says 20 new skills, but you can only get rid of that by buying the skill. Like, you can't get rid of the notification without buying the skill, but to buy the skill, you obviously need skill points and resources. Yeah. So I don't know whether that's something that can easily be fixed
in a patch of just hide that stuff. But
the UI update, yeah.
Yeah, the tutorial is garbage and may have been part of the reason why we didn't necessarily do too well on the first few missions. But it was still fun.
Yeah, it definitely went on my radar in terms of like games I will be buying like in the near future.
Yeah.
Like it was nice like not to have another game on my list of things to buy, but the beta was just I have some really great clips saved that I've been planning on putting together into a video, but just ridiculous things like it's just such a blast just cruising through, and then even just falling off your motorcycle and torpedoing down a mountain, like as your body like just crashes into a rock. The physics are super fun. I will say some of the driving is a little slippery. I feel like if you're going really fast, the car just like whoa.
Particularly if you're playing on a keyboard.
Oh, I can imagine that without like being able to just tilt slightly.
Matt was the expert driver because he was playing with his controller.
Nice.
Nice. Yeah.
Great game though. I mean,
I do like that. I enjoyed it, but that it's not so pressing on my mind of I really need to buy this game that I have to buy it straight away.
Not on launch. Yeah, sale sounds good.
Yeah,
I would be instantly in like $20 off.
It is a shame that Ebby's not able to play the beta because she was kind of half interested in the co-op element of it, and I think that she probably could enjoy it in a explore the world with friends and do some stealth and things like that. It's not because I'm not so heavy into the shootings and things like she is, and it was satisfying enough. It wasn't so demanding that I felt like I was incompetent. I died maybe twice due to being shot a ton. And I got some decent kills in. It feels good. It's not too hard in that regard. It's pretty forgiving on the you failed the stealth aspect. You can just be like, okay, now it's cover time. Shoot the dudes. Get the intel or whatever. But the times that we did do sort of stealth, wherein two people would distract by shooting and one of us would run in not noticed and do what needed to be done and then just run away being like
the sound tactic definitely works.
It's nice that your squad doesn't have shared noticed.
I like that a lot.
The other thing that we found really weird was that even though the mission based supplies apply to everyone, like if you steal a helicopter everyone gets the 2500 health or whatever, tagging supplies in the wild isn't shared among the squad, which is like, well, that logically means then that you've told the rebels four times to come out to this one barrel of oil, which doesn't really make sense. I don't know why that's not shared.
And it's annoying mechanically too. Like I'm all the way on this side of the outpost. I found some supplies over here, but you're doing like your little sneak around over there. I guess you'll have to come all the way over here at some point to get these instead of it just triggering for your whole party.
Yeah.
Just a little tedium.
Again, that's something that could very easily be patched, but I don't know whether they will.
I could see them not.
Yeah. That's the sad
bit. But I agree on the complaint. Speaking of the multiplayer and co-op and Ebby enjoying the co-op, I have been surprised to hear that the Final Fantasy 15 co-op is going to be avatar based and not you playing as one of the four men.
Yes, I did see that there was character creation. So Bill unfortunately spoiled something in Final Fantasy 15 by mistake here. I've cut it out and sort of rejigged the audio to try and make sense as much as possible, but if it's still a little bit weird, that's why, and I apologize for that.
It will likely take place within that period.
Yeah.
And I assume it will probably be a lot of demon hunting, but I think it would be really cool to see the land the way it is more in depth.
I mean, that was our main complaint about that part of the game, really.
And I think it will be great to play it with you guys.
I will have to rebuy Final Fantasy and get the season pass.
I've gotten a new copy. Sorry, that was dumb.
I've acquired a new copy.
But yeah, so that just rang in my head for a second there. But yeah, Wildlands, cool. Game's on my radar now.
Yep.
Fun beta. I'm glad they do betas.
Yeah, I'm not going to pick it up on Uplay, though. Because the Uplay friend adding system is awful for me. Like, the in-browser, even though the Steam version still uses Uplay, from my past experience, it works significantly better. So I would probably pick it up there.
Cool. Yeah, the Uplay browser thing, I had to add friends to get for them to be able to send me one of the codes for the closed beta.
Yeah.
And that is a...
Even on console, which seems so weird.
Yeah, I hate that system. I don't mind Uplay necessarily.
I guess them stopping people like selling codes or whatever. It's like you've got to be a friend with this person on Uplay. Sense. I don't know. So if you pick it up, you're going to be the unfortunate one who picks it up on PlayStation, right?
Too many steps. Yes.
God damn.
Sorry.
We need an Andy replacement.
I'm not sure if I'm much better at our specific game. So it would just be like having an American Andy running around.
Yeah, but that could be all the difference.
Have you been playing anything else besides the Wildlands beta?
Played a bit of Heroes, Fire Emblem Heroes.
Nice. Have we talked about that on show at all?
I don't think we have. It's maybe we have. Would have been.
I feel like we in some capacity, but I think it might have been pre-launch when I said I'm glad it's not chibi art. For the character like portraits. Obviously it's chibi art for the battles. Yeah. But like for the portraits, I was glad they didn't go like Funko looking shit or something. But
speaking of, have you seen the Dory Funko?
No. Is it hideous?
Look it up.
Let's see.
But meanwhile I'll talk about Fire Emblem Heroes.
Finding Dory Funko.
I haven't played it much recently, the last week or so, because my phone's battery's been appalling. Have you just seen it? I'll throw an image up on the video.
I want to say that I'm not typically against some variations of the pop figure. Some of them work better than others. Some of them are absolutely absolute abominations.
Yeah.
This Dory one scares the shit out of me.
It's amazing. Like,
it's like I'm tempted, it's to, like I'm tempted to buy it.
Jay Leto? Jared Leto? Joker that, Nendoroid?
That Joker Nendoroid is nightmare fuel.
Which do you think is worse, that Nendoroid or that Funko Pop?
The Funko.
Yeah.
At least, I mean, like, the essence of Jared Leto's Joker is in that Nendoroid. This is some
it doesn't,
weird...
If, unless
fucking,
it said Dory on it, I'd be like, what the hell is this?
Yeah, who made this? This is someone made out of Play-Doh. It's really scary looking. But yeah, anyway,
yeah,
Fire Emblem Heroes.
I haven't played much this week. There is an event going on at the moment for new heroes.
Cool.
But because I haven't been playing, my levels are somewhat poor. So I can't actually reliably partake in that. It basically works like Fire Emblem. It's a super simplified version in terms of the combat. There's no item swapping out. There's no weapon swapping out. There's no equipping items. It's literally... it's basically rock, paper, scissors of the attack triangle. Swords beats axe. Axe beats lance. Lance beats sword. And then you've got the archers and the magic people who sort of don't really get affected by anything. And there's an element of classes in there, in that archers still wreck Pegasus Knights. But it's enjoyable. The battles take maybe 5 minutes. So it's a nice quick little skirmish. You get your orbs if you're doing a story mode or whatever. I will say I spent about £20 on the game for optimal hero receiving. Because the orbs in the beginning were kind of hard to come by. It was literally from beating story missions.
And unless you got some reasonable heroes from your drops, mm-hmm. Some of the latest story missions would be impossible to beat. So you weren't getting more orbs. It seems like they've fixed that now. Every day you're getting 2 orbs for logging in. And I think that they're later adding more ways to get orbs. So.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
That's always one of the... I played it that first day it came out for a little bit. Mm-hmm. And then not much after. Not because the game is bad or anything. I'm just really bad at keeping up with mobile games like that.
Yeah.
Like I really like those games, like those types of games. Like I like the one I played the most, Granblue Fantasy. It's one of the biggest ones in Japan. I got hooked on that one for a bit, but then I kind of start falling behind because like once you like forget to like log in a bit, to log in a day, you start missing out on bonuses, and you're like, well, fuck it, I'm not playing anymore because I'm an idiot.
My biggest problem with it is because it's a mobile game, I feel like I shouldn't be playing it at home. But home is the only place I could reliably play it because of my battery. It needs to be plugged in to play.
Yeah.
I think I just need to get over that because I did enjoy it.
Slick game.
It is. I don't like how variable the character art is. Some people look amazing, and then there's people like Arthur who look like absolute trash. and it just really... That ruins it for me of saying, oh, look, Crom looks amazing. This guy looks like he was drawn in paint. yeah.
Is that like for the portraits or like
the actual
like,
character the art.
Sprites? Like the
you know, when they're attacking? The massive image.
Oh, the one that pops up?
Yeah, I'll try and find.
But yeah, it's a really slick game. Like it runs beautifully on all the devices I've tried it on, like on my tablet and my phone. The UI is really good. It's not like some of these mobile RPGs, like their main hub screens are such a clusterfuck of like buttons and information and little mailboxes and gem icons and like guild buttons and like Jesus, somebody teach these people how to design a UI. So like it was refreshing to even Granblue Fantasy, the one that I typically play, is just the main hub screen is just a fucking sea of buttons. It's nice to like open up Fire Emblem Heroes and like it's really slick and like
it did take a little while to find where all the stuff was, but like just exploring the buttons, everything became sort of self-explanatory. Yeah. You're like, okay, this is my friends list, this is where I get my quests.
There's always a lot of like in these mobile RPGs, there's always a lot of screens that I never know exactly what they do until I just start fucking with them. Like, and a lot of them always have the same features, like fusing heroes or like combining heroes, or that's the same as fusing, but like scrapping ones to make certain ones more powerful, and like they always use different terminology and stuff like that. And those menus always are daunting to me because like I always feel like I'm not doing what I'm supposed to be doing when I'm doing that. Like, oh, I just definitely just wasted a whole bunch of things making that guy more powerful. Oh, well.
Oh, that's something I will say. The cost, I don't know whether this is something they're patching as well, but the cost of getting... So you can upgrade from 1-star to 2-star to 3-star to 4-star to 5.
Yeah.
Going from 1 to 3 isn't too bad. You use feathers, which you earn in the arena. In the pseudo competitive mode, depending on how you place, you get more feathers at the end. The cost to get from 4 rank to 5 rank is ridiculous. I think it's something like 20,000 feathers. And you get like 1,000 if you're lucky from a good competitive. I'm just going to open the game up now, so I apologize if the sound comes through.
Sure.
Because I want to get that information right. Which, if your Ebby is super unfortunate, because she's only gotten one level 5-star hero in the form of Camilla, whereas I've had like 4 or 5 just from...
Yeah, I got 2 5-star Lucinas right in a row. My first ever pool. I felt like a dirty man.
Particularly since you've got to scrap one of them Lucinas. Or merge them, I suppose.
Yeah. I would have preferred to have gotten 2 different 5-star heroes, but I guess I use it to make it more powerful. But
So that is unfortunate. All right, allies, advanced growth, unlock potential.
Yeah, so to go from level rank 4 to rank 5 uses 20,000 feathers and requires 10 advanced gems. I have no idea how you get these advanced gems. I can only find shards. So my Robin's never going to level up. My Anna's never going to level up until I work out something. And I've only got 9,850 feathers. Most of those were from the tweet promotion that they did of if this tweet reaches X number of retweets in 24 hours, everyone gets 10,000 free feathers.
Oh, yeah. I remember that.
So, yeah, that needs fixing. They either need to make it so that it's cheaper or feathers are easier to come by. I think they said that they're working on that to be in a March update.
Cool.
Other than that, the only other thing that I've been playing is Heroes of the Storm.
Ooh, a MOBA!
Yeah, sorry. Yeah. Because there's an event going...
the MOBA Pro.
Well, not really. There's an event going on where you can get a new mount, so I've been... But you've got to play with friends, so I've dragged Evie in for a few games. We haven't finished it yet. But I also played my first two games against real people.
How'd that go? Harder or easier than bots?
The first one, I'd say, was about the same as what I've been playing on the bots. Unfortunately, someone in chat said, no one's taking top, someone take top. So I'm like, okay, I'll go take top. No one was coming along top, it was just minions, but this guy was a significantly higher level than me, so I'm like, okay, he probably knows what he's talking about, so I'm doing all this killing on minions, and the game progresses, we're winning. And then halfway through the game, the same guy goes, what the hell are you doing, Valor? Why haven't you gotten any kills or whatever? You're just farming minions. I'm like, because you told me to stay in the top. This is my first game with people. I said that earlier. So I was just doing what you said. And then I said, so what would you prefer me to be doing? And he never responded until the end of the game at the voting thing of, like in Overwatch, the cards.
Yeah.
He just said, Valor, noob. And I'm like, look, I asked for your help.
Oh, no.
And you didn't offer me anything, so I did what you told me. Have a good day. Still won. The second game, we got absolutely wrecked. And I don't know why. I think that they were just significantly better than any AI I had played against.
Any toxic people in that round?
No. There was a point where you obviously realized that you can't really recover. You probably could if you were to be playing with people in comms and actually be like, okay, we could go do this, that, and the other. But the enemy guys were toying with us because obviously they knew that they'd won. And they were taking their time with it. It's just like, come on. Come on. But yeah, it's still enjoyable. I enjoy it. Lucio is great fun.
Oh, nice. Yeah, I forgot about that.
So yeah, I spent my £8 on Lucio. I enjoy him. Yeah, it's a game that we always, Ebby and I, enjoy playing, but we always forget that we enjoy playing it because we play so much Overwatch.
Yeah.
And it's something that we can't play that much because people would obviously prefer to play Overwatch to Heroes. So it's one of those things that we just play every now and again and have a bit of fun with the AI.
Yeah, it's a good game. Blizzard makes good games. One of my favorite things about Heroes is the fact that it has multiple maps opposed to like Dota or
I was saying League. That to Abby. It's like, it's really nice. It's some refreshing. Of the maps are less fun, but the fact that there's a rotation where we can go, yes, it's doubloons. We love that doubloon map so much.
Is that the Booty Bay one, I think?
Or Blackheart Bay or something, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, it's so much fun to farm doubloons. It's always sad when we win, because it's like, oh, no more doubloons.
Like, it's nice to get in a MOBA a different map with dynamic objectives over... Oh, it's the same three lanes, and there's some guy in the jungle. There's, two.
I mean, that's
useful bottom.
For those games because they're so much more complex in their
hero
loadouts
sure.
that you don't
for
want
sure.
to be worrying about different map objectives. It's like, okay, you know the map, you know what you're doing. And because
I'm a casual,
because Hearthstone Heroes is I guess, mechanically simpler. It can it can add that variation in the map.
Easier to adapt to that, yeah, because there's less that you need to worry about.
There's like 20 things that you worry about in Heroes rather than a 100 lot. Items that have different benefits when you equip them with other items. It's just like, no. Nope. Not for me.
MOBAs. Uncrackable genre for me. Uncrackable.
Abby thought the same. I thought the same. You should join us for Heroes.
I have played Heroes.
With us. We only play against AI.
But chill out, play some Heroes of the Storm. Yeah, I could try out some of the overall. Who do they add? Tracer.
So they've got Zarya, Tracer is, I think, exclusive to if you bought the Origins Edition.
Well, my account is linked with the Origins Edition.
Oh, is it? Oh yeah, because of the PlayStation. Zarya and Lucio.
I got my Winston pet in World of Warcraft.
Nice. But yeah, there's an event to play 15 games. As a Warcraft hero with friends, to get a mount in Warcraft and mount in Heroes. So that goes on until March the 14th. So you should.
I missed the Genji event. You should. And I'm really angry with myself for that.
You should join us for this awesome flaming horse mount.
You know what? Maybe I will.
Oh my god! That'll definitely pass the time between now and Zelda. It would be to play a crap ton of Heroes.
And then you don't buy Zelda because you're
I haven't already paid for it, but I've pretty much paid for all of that.
It just sits there collecting dust as you play Heroes of the Storm.
I mean, maybe, but it'll be waiting for me, ready.
Anything else? Any other video games?
I don't think so.
Cool.
Now that we do have this regular plan set in place, I am going to start writing down the stuff that I play over a month.
It's a good plan.
Because previously it was like, I don't know when we're going to record next. I'm not going to write down every game I play for 3 months. I can start doing that.
It's a good plan. Luckily, I've been playing the same 2-3 games since January, beginning of January. Although one of the newer ones is For Honor.
I played the beta for that.
That has been... I have about 50 hours into For Honor already since it came out. I'm a really big fan of this game. I think it's a great game, but it is not perfect. Not a perfect game. There's nothing else like it. So, like, I appreciate the game a lot. And initially, I had a really turbulent relationship with this video game. I absolutely hated the closed beta with a burning I hated it so much. I never instantly went from looking forward to a game to wanting to destroy it in a quicker amount of time. I did not know I was getting a fighting game, basically, when it comes to learning these characters. I thought it was mostly going to be like Chivalry, where you're just kind of swiping around.
I think that's what most people are at. They don't like the people that don't realize it's a fighting game. Like, they didn't market it as one. Like, clearly is one, but not everyone's like, wait a minute, this is a fighting game. This is really...
The 4v4 modes, garbage. Kind of... I'm not a fan.
That's all I played, admittedly, because I didn't feel competent enough to play in the duels or the 2v2 or whatever.
Yeah,
but 4v4 is awful.
I am insanely addicted to 1v1, kind of the same way I would get addicted to 1v1 Rocket League. And it's going to sound insane, but I have a bruise on my thigh from... losing a match. You got to take your anger out somewhere, you know? And instead of harming things you buy, like controllers or desks,
harm yourself.
Take it out of yourself. I'm insanely addicted to the 1v1 mode, and I get some enjoyment out of some of the 4v4, but the 4v4 is currently broken for one reason, and that is gear stats, and they do not belong in this game at all. I want to sit down with Jason Vanderberg or whatever fucker at Ubisoft decided, we're going to make this really awesome melee combat system. The 1v1s are going to be super intense. You're going to have moments defending off multiple characters. It feels good when you swing. You get all these different moves and different character types. And then on top of that, we're going to add pieces of gear that change your stats around so that players who are super high level and have all this rare and legendary gear that increase their revenge meter, their revenge attack, their revenge duration, so that when you come upon them in matchmaking, because our matchmaking system is apparently run by a bunch of mice, you have the opportunity as a level 10 up against some prestige 4 fucking Shugoki, who, because his stats are so borked due to this unbalanced gear, 2 or 3 hits on him has him fully charged with his revenge already, and it barely runs out. He has his revenge attack maxed out, so he's basically one-shotting you. Like, I have no idea. It is the most baffling decision to put gears, like, to put, like, MMO gear in this skill-based fighting game.
Yeah.
It's non-existent in 1v1 and 2v2 modes, so you don't have to worry about it there. I maybe understand it maybe in Dominion, because it's like, oh, it's like a MMO PvP. You know, it's big team. Yeah. You're capturing points. You know, you want some progression. But there's no excuse for the gear stats. It's almost as if they needed an excuse to sell the in-game currency, the crates and shit. Like, oh, people want to buy money for better gear. But it's already been expressed with great success that just cosmetics sell. If this gear was just strictly cosmetic, it would still be a draw for the cash shop. Like, Overwatch is great proof of that. People will go absolutely bananas for cosmetics. It bums me out that I love this game a lot, and it bums me out that that side of the game is hampered by gear. It really bums me out because, like, there's no way to matchmake it, because the problem with it is, it matchmakes you before you pick your character. And the way the gear system works in this game is every 20 levels, you go up a reputation rank with that character. Kind of like prestige. Mm-hmm. Like, you'll hit level 20, you level up one more time. It resets your level back to 1, but now you'll get better gear out of the boxes. And then every 20 levels, it does the same. So by the time you're at prestige rank 3, you're getting, like, purple gear out of the boxes and from, like, completing matches. And, like, those are significantly better, obviously, than the pieces of shit gear that you're getting from, you know, level 1 through 20. And then even reputation rank 1, you're not getting very good gear. So, but what happens is, because all of that stuff is tied to an individual character, and because it's matchmaking you prior to your character selection, there's no way to balance the matchmaking based on gear score, because they have no idea what character you're going to pick before they matchmake you. So they matchmake everybody, everyone's in the lobby. Oh, I'm going to pick my prestige rank 6 Shugoki, or maybe I'll pick my rank 1 Nobushi or something. Mm-hmm. And, like, I'd like to hear from them what the, like, because skill-based matchmaking is not a solution for this, because it doesn't matter if you're matching me with a guy who has the same hidden skill ranking as me, because my skill rating might be high because I win a lot of 1v1s, whereas his skill rating might be high because he wins a lot of 4v4s because he's so much higher level than me. So it's really fucking...
So they just need to change the order of how it works, of rather than matchmake, then choose character, you need to choose your character, then matchmake.
That would fix it.
You can have time. 4 of the same class on your team anyway, so it's not like team balance is a thing. It's just
Nobody really does, like, comps or anything like that.
You don't know what the enemies pick, so if there is any sort of benefit, like, this guy's better at that guy, there's no sort of
you don't find out until it starts. So that would 100, I mean, at least in my eyes, if you are going to play Dominion and you are, you know, have you pick your higher level character first, boom, then it can match you with other people who are picking higher level or within that range anyway, you know. Now, one way I assume they are maybe doing it is every time you increase a prestige rank on one of your characters, it gets added to a total account prestige level.
Yeah.
So right now I have 2 characters at prestige 1, the Valkyrie and the Berserker. So when I go to my account, I am a reputation level 2. Because those two are added together.
Mm-hmm.
And so maybe I assume it will eventually, once everybody, like, evens out and more people start playing the game, like, it might match me with people whose account is a total of prestige 2.
But then...
So that there's nobody higher, like, they don't have any characters higher than at least prestige 1, because... But then it gets tough because
like, there's 12 classes at the minute? So you could be...
Yeah.
If you get prestige 1... on all of them, your account will be 12, but that could be everyone's at rank 1, or you've got 2 people at 6. Yeah.
Yeah, and that, yeah, and again, yeah, there is a problem in that for sure, now that you say, because, yeah, I have all them at Prestige 1. My account is Prestige 12, so if it were to match me with somebody who's Prestige 12 and they are just Prestige 12 on one character, then they're going to be an absolute beast. So it's a... there's no way to retroactively do it now because, like, in hindsight, people have already spent money on steel, and then they have already spent money on crates, so they've already gotten gear. I would just love for them to just sit down and go, we're taking stats off of all the gear. The game is so much more fun when it is not imbalanced with MMO gear. It just makes no sense why it's in there. Like, I scratch my head at it every time. Like, I don't get it, because there's three 4v4 modes: Dominion, Skirmish, and Elimination. Elimination is basically the super serious 2v2 mode, but with four player teams. And for some reason, this 4v4 elimination mode has buffs. Yeah. And like, I don't understand, because there's already Skirmish, which is team deathmatch with buffs, where you respawn. Cool. That's fine. That's a crazy mode. It's team deathmatch. There's no points you have to capture. You can respawn. It's just total carnage. The buffs belong in there, because you're respawning. It doesn't matter. It's fun. It's like a Quake deathmatch. Elimination, to me, is super serious, like 2v2 or 1v1, where you are faced off against an opponent. When you die, you die. Like, you can get resurrected if they don't execute you, but, like, that is, to me, what would be a ranked mode. 1v1, 2v2, and 4v4. Elimination. I don't know why it's grouped in with the gear score-based buff modes. I don't... Like, what the fuck? Like, it's weird. I love this game a lot. All I've been doing the entire time talking about it is ragging on it. But the only reason I'm ragging on it so much is because, like, that part of the game is bumming me out, because everything else, like, I think is really good. But some class balance issues aside, that's always going to be present in every multiplayer game. I think they really nailed the combat. I think they nailed the music. I think the look of the game is cool. I think it's got a really addictive progression curve in terms of your skill, which I think is what all the game needed. Was that addiction to progressing skill-wise. So the gear thing just bums me out. Bums me out so much.
My relationship with For Honor was never great to begin with. I tried to play it on PC, and no matter what I did, it wouldn't launch. It would start to play, and then it would just quit. It would never actually boot up. So eventually I played it on the PlayStation. I think I got... And that was like a day and a half of me trying to fix it on the PC... on all sorts of random fixes. I think I only managed to play 4 matches, because that was all I could really bear, because the only mode that I felt like I had a shot in was Dominion. But every single game was 3v1, and that was just like, well, I can't capture these points because no one else is around and it's 3v1, so I'm just going to die now. And so I came out thinking, when it was 1v1 or 1v2, it was enjoyable, it was tense. I felt like I had a shot, but they played better than me. But the majority of the game was 3v1, at which point I don't have a hope in hell.
No, I don't even try.
So... I would never buy the game because of that. Because I wouldn't want to go into duels, because I don't have the practice and I don't really want to be going. To me, I equate that to competitive in Overwatch. If I don't really go into competitive and think, I've never played Widowmaker before, I'm going to play her now in this super serious... the ranking system, it's like, well, no, I want to have a good handle of the person that I'm playing as. I probably will never buy For Honor.
Yeah. I wouldn't blame you. Especially with my warnings of the 4v4 modes being a kind of a mess right now. As fun as they can be with people you know, because you can kind of coordinate and group up and perform things. Like, I had a... one thing I really like, one of my favorite mechanics from the Dominion mode, is the break system. I really like how easy it is to kind of turn the tide of the score of the game. Like, when you hold a point, you temporarily have the 100 points associated with that point. And when you lose it, that 100 points gets deducted from your score. So, like, the flipping of the points, like, that those few hundred points that are divided between those or added between those can, like, really flip between the teams really easily if the points are flipping back and forth. And then say, like, our team hits 1,000 points, the enemy team starts breaking.
Yep.
And they have the option to either decrease our points below 1,000 or... when they die, they won't respawn. So they have limited lives to kind of try to turn the tide of battle, which can get pretty intense. Which I like that a lot because it provides some intense moments.
I've also heard that there is a totally necessary but optional tutorial beyond the basic tutorial.
Yeah, advanced tutorial. I don't know why they don't have you do that right after it without letting you choose no, because it introduces some mechanics that I think everyone needs to know.
Or at least know about, even if you can't necessarily pull them off. Because I've heard that there's like the blocking system can be unblocked by advanced tutorial stuff, and thus you need to know about parrying to deal
guard
with that.
Guard breaking, parrying, counter guard breaking, all that stuff, fainting, all that stuff is very important.
Which, in but seeing as how it's encounters. A fighting game, it would be like if you didn't know that you could grab in Pokken, for instance, is like you don't know a third of the movesets or whatever. It's just like, no, that's ridiculous.
They probably should have just rolled it all into one big tutorial instead of doing basic and advanced. Like, that stuff's just as necessary as being able to attack. Like, counter, people are going to spam guard break a lot. Like, knowing how to counter guard break is necessary against some people in duels and even Dominion. Like that shit is necessary, I think, anyway, after playing the game a lot. Interesting game. I really like it. I'm going to continue to play it. I actually said last night, though, I think I'm going to put it down for a bit. They're announcing their first big balance patch this week with whatever changes are going to be in it. They're going to be buffing one of my favorite characters, so I'm looking forward to that. But I'm also curious to see if they're going to do anything related to the modes and anything else regarding anything but just character balance. But also, the game just makes me so mad, like Rocket League does.
Yeah.
And I don't have the luxury of just, like, willy-nilly uninstalling and reinstalling it, like Rocket League, which is a smaller game. This is, like, 40 gigs. I can't just keep Rage uninstalling For Honor. So if the game's making me too mad, I need to just step back from it and play some Yakuza and get happy. So I was actually playing it last night, and I just said to myself, like, okay, I think it's break time for a bit. I put 50 hours into it. That's a lot. In a short amount of time it's been out, I can set it down for a bit.
Did it come out this week or last week?
Last week.
Okay. Yeah.
It came out on the 14th. Valentine's Day. Perfect day for smashing heads in.
Well, yeah. I don't know what else you'd do on Valentine's Day.
No. Kill people with axes. Mm. Speaking of killing people with axes, the final game that I've been playing...
Resident Evil.
I'm really glad you mentioned that, Kinross, because I got a chance to try Resident Evil in VR.
Oh, God.
I'm a really big believer in VR. I've gotten to play the PlayStation VR a lot, a lot of what they have on offer at a friend's place, and I truly love it. I want one of my own, but like a Switch comes before that, and then a PSVR when there's more stuff out for it. And when it's available, because the PSVR is sold out like everywhere in the area, and it has been for months, so it's a little rough. But I got a chance to play through like the first 2 hours of Resident Evil in VR uninterrupted, and I am probably going to ask if I can borrow that from my cousin, because I won't ever play this game. I bought Resident Evil 7 for my dad for Christmas because he's a big Resident Evil fan. So the game is in my house, and I watched him play a good bit of it, most of the game, actually.
Yeah.
I'll watch someone play it. I won't play it myself. So I watched him play a lot of it. So like, the game's fantastic if you're a Resident Evil fan or just a survival horror fan in general. They really nailed it. But I played the first 2 hours in VR, and... oh my God. I really wish someone was filming, because I have never screamed and like convulsed in such an intense way in my life. There was a point in the game when you're looking for your missing girlfriend.
Yeah, I've seen the first hour or so. It's taken me, since its release, that's as far as I've gotten in my watching.
Oh, God, cough. It's the part where you find her, and it's like after a fight with her in the basement or in the attic, or you fight her at some point, and then
when you're opening
her body disappears. And you're walking by like the stairs that go up.
Yeah.
And she pops out of the door on the left hand side, like a closet or whatever. Yeah. And that's when I think she like cuts your hand off then, or she does something to you at that point.
Mm-hmm.
But I like playing with the VR. It's really awesome because you could peek around corners and stuff.
Yeah.
So like I like was just looking around every corner and every room, and I saw her walk. I thought she walked upstairs, so I put off going upstairs for a second, and I went into the other room, and then I was walking back. And I was about to walk past the door, and I'm jokingly, like, my dad's there, my cousin's there. I'm jokingly, like, oh, she ain't going to catch me by surprise. And I, like move my head around the corner, and she jumps out of that room. And I was just not I thought she was upstairs, and I'm just like, oh, I'm just messing with the head tracking, looking around corners. My ass lifted so far up off the seat, I started, like, shaking and screaming. Like, just a startle. Like, the VR is amazing with that game. I didn't play too much of it. Oh, the scene where... Oh, I assume you probably haven't gotten to this part yet, where you're fighting
the bit where
Jack.
Is Jack the dad?
Yeah, like in the garage.
Yeah, I've seen that's as far as I got. The garage thing happened, and
yeah,
they've just left the garage.
That part in VR was nuts. Because when he rips the top of the car off, or when he's on top of the car, and like you could look up at him. Oh my God, I was dying in that chair. I couldn't take it.
The only thing of VR that I saw was when you're opening the door to the basement and you see the steps and you've got to go down. And I was like, nope.
Is that the scene where like she comes up at you?
Yeah.
Yep. See, now it's convenient because I watched my dad play a lot of the game, but I didn't see him play any of the beginning. Oh. He started that when I wasn't home. So, like, none of this stuff I was expecting. Mm-hmm. So, like, it worked out well because, like, if you know when the scares are coming, even with VR on, you're expecting it. Like, oh my God, it was really immersive.
My issue
really
is
cool.
It legitimately terrifies me. It's in a similar sort of vein of, I mean, it's better than PT because PT I could not watch at all.
Yeah.
So the fact that I've managed to make myself watch an hour of this so far, I mean, it's taken forever, but I'm genuinely curious as to what the hell's going on, and I want to know what's going on, but it is so hard to get through as someone who can't stand survival horror, or horror in general. It's just, oh.
Yeah, they really nailed the story and the setting and the creepiness. Which I'm really glad because Resident Evil was in a dire spot within the fan community. So I'm really glad. I mean, it's still a little divisive. Some people aren't a fan of where they took it, but generally it's pretty positive, and that's pretty great to see. But the game I've been playing besides that has been Neo.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember if I've talked about the Neo Alpha or Beta on here before. I'm not gonna get too in depth with Neo because I could probably almost talk about Neo for like an hour.
That's the white
and I don't
guy in Japan,
to.
Right?
Yeah. Who looks like Geralt from The Witcher. He's based on a real guy.
Yes.
William Adams. He is a sailor who washed ashore in Japan and ended up becoming a samurai.
He's played by Tom
really
Cruise,
neat.
Was he not?
What's that is a different story, but it is very similar.
I know.
what's really neat, what they did with Neo is they really kind of push that like foreigner in a strange land concept by like William will speak in his accent and in English, but he'll come across Japanese people who are speaking Japanese. So he doesn't understand certain characters. And so it isn't just, oh, there's always Japanese people speaking English and he just understands them. Like there are very much moments with certain characters where he just has no fucking clue what's going on. And he has to do his best to understand. Now there are certain Japanese characters who will speak in broken English. But they do a pretty good job of that. But, the story kind of isn't why I'm playing that game.
Sorry, just a moment. So from your perspective,
If he's not understanding them, are you also not understanding, or is it like they're subtitled so you know what they're saying and he's just
clueless? Subtitle, yeah. Okay. Yeah, they subtitle so you know what's going on. It is the exact game I was expecting. Like, I played the alpha for a long time. Then they had a beta and then another demo, which neither of those two I touched, even though you got some cosmetics if you beat them in the you got some cosmetics for the full game. I just didn't want to burn out before the fucking game came out, because the game is insanely long. It is exactly what I wanted. It is super fast, like Bloodborne. It has a very similar style of progression to Bloodborne and Souls, whereas every time you kill something, you get Amrita, which are basically the souls, and you put those towards leveling up. When you die, you reset at a shrine, you get to go back and get your Amrita back from where you died, and there's little gravestones of players, mm-hmm. like real players who died in those areas, just like in Dark Souls and Bloodborne. The cool twist on that, though, in Neo is that you don't see how they died, where like in Dark Souls and Bloodborne, when you'd come across like a blood stain, you click that and it shows you how that, like the last 20 seconds of that player's life. Whereas in this, you get to fight an AI version mm-hmm. of that player's character with the exact same gear they had on, the exact same items they were using, magic, whatever. It like saves the data of how that person was playing before they died, and you get to fight a version of them, and you have a chance to get a piece of the gear that they were wearing when they died. So like in certain higher level areas, you get kind of a preview of what they're wearing. Like, you can kind of see the quality of gear. So if you come across a gravestone of a player and you see that he's wearing like a really good axe, you don't get to see what axe specifically, but it's like yellow quality. You can be like, okay, I want to try to fight this guy's guy because I want to see if I can get that axe. It's a really addictive loop of like entering a Twilight mission, which is like a really hard version of an existing mission, and just entering it and seeing all of the dead players there and just going, well, my next 5 hours are set. I'm fighting all these motherfuckers and trying to get all this gear. It's a really addictive loop. Mm-hmm. It combines feudal Japan, yokai type stuff, like all of that, like Japanese mythology, with the like progression system of Souls and Bloodborne, the combat of Bloodborne and Ninja Gaiden, and the loot system of Diablo, all rolled into one game. And it's like they just gifted me this present of the perfect build game, and I've just been super addicted to it. It's just so long, though, that I have kind of sat it down for a minute while I finish Yakuza.
I like the sound of half of that stuff. The half that I don't like is the Bloodborne Souls element.
Yeah.
In terms of, because the thing that you sort of associate with Bloodborne Dark Souls is the difficulty and how ridiculous it is. In that regard, where does Neo fall on the difficulty scale? Is it as hard as nails as those, or is it sort of kinder to you because it's got these other systems in place?
It is, I would say it's as hard, like on paper, like right out the gate. Like on its own, bare bones, like these boss fights are really difficult. Enemies in between boss fights can be not as difficult. Like, they're easier to figure out. The boss fights are hard. They certainly have their tricky enemies and their tricky areas. But it can be alleviated more so in this game than in like Bloodborne or Souls, because it's possible to, like, as I was saying, farm those dead players. And like you can get a one up on certain areas by trying to farm gear, mm-hmm. Much like in Diablo, where if I can't get past this act on Torment, it's too hard. Let me go back and like play around in some things I've already done and like increase my gear, like get better quality weapons or better quality armor, or like get skill points and unlock magic. Because whereas in this game, opposed to Bloodborne and Souls, you also have skill trees for each weapon type and for ninjutsu and for omnio magic, mm-hmm. Which unlock things that make these encounters much easier to deal with.
Okay.
So they have methods in place to where you can deal with things a little easier than in Bloodborne. Because like in Bloodborne, you have like your weapon types and your skill, like your own raw talent. And that's really what it comes down to in Bloodborne. You know, you could pump your skill points into things that make it a little easier, but whereas in Neo, you have some more tools at your disposal, most notably in the aspect of farming gear like Diablo, because like gear makes a big difference. If you can get some good weapons, it's easier to take stuff down fairly quickly. Like my gear right now is just really good, and I'm not steamrolling through levels because the bosses are still hard, mm-hmm. and there are still some tricky areas, but I am in a pretty decent set of equipment right now to where certain things just kind of become not trivial but easier to take down.
Okay.
The game is still hard, yeah. though. It is still pretty damn frustrating at times.
I'm going to have to get over my dislike of things being super hard and cruel because, as we said earlier, Zelda is brutal. Mm-hmm. With the killing other players to get their loot, if they kill you, can you go back to that spot and fight them again, or is it like a one chance thing of you wasted it, you can't get that anymore?
It disappears.
Okay.
So it can be risky, especially if you're deep in a level and you don't want to risk like resetting all the enemies, because that's how it goes in these games. It could be like, oh man, this guy's dead body has like a really good axe and I haven't gotten a new axe in a while. Now it's risky because one, he might not drop that specific piece of equipment. Like, you're not guaranteed any one piece. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they don't drop anything, so it could be kind of risky. There are like certain things you can get that increase drop rates, like items and scrolls and whatnot. So you know, it's the risk of if I die here, I'm gonna have to restart all the way back to the beginning of the level or the last checkpoint that I unlocked, and I won't get a second shot at his. Now I have noticed,
of course, he'll be
sometimes
fighting you with a better axe.
Yes. So and some of the AI for some of the revenants is what they're called. these dead spirits that you're fighting, the revenants, can be very annoying to fight, especially if like some of when they died, if they had like any really good magic equipped or something, it can be really frustrating to handle them. But I have noticed that some of them that have beaten me, I have seen their revenant pop back up at some point throughout the level.
Okay.
So you might randomly get a second shot if you're lucky at finding them again.
But it's not the same. Typically, it's not as going, like, you remember them being by that lamppost. You can't
go back
there.
Yeah, they won't be there again. Okay. Precisely, yeah, they disappear, at least as far as I have played, unless they, like, there's a duration, unless you wait like an hour and they pop back up. Mm-hmm. As far as I know, as soon as I go back to get my body or the souls that I've gathered, that revenant is gone.
Okay.
So risk and reward type situation. It's really addictive though to go through those. They are adding actual PvP in March.
Okay.
No, April. April is the PvP. There's a free DLC coming out in March, mm-hmm. but the PvP is happening in April. But yeah, it's neat. Each weapon has three stances, which is really fun, which I really like. High stance is like a really like stamina draining, like high damage attack.
Mm-hmm.
Middle stance is kind of your middle of the road. It's like, it's got speed, but it's also got power. And then there's low stance, which is low damage, but really fast, like harasser type speed that you could just spam quick attacks, and like dodge quicker and stuff. So there's a lot of depth in the combat, so it's a lot of fun. The weapon types are fun to mess around in. The environments are cool. I really like that whole like feudal Japan, like the whole mythology of Japan. I like the yokai type stuff, and I like the setting, and the music's cool, and it runs at 60 frames, which is really nice and smooth.
Kind of important for that sort of game.
Yeah, I wish Bloodborne ran at 60 frames. Yeah, it's just my only complaint with the game. The only thing that bothers me, and I can feel it, it's probably not a bad idea that I've shelved it for right now until I beat Yakuza, is that enemy variety kind of gets scarce. Like, I'm like maybe 20, 30 hours into the game, and once you've kind of gotten your fill of a certain amount of enemy types, you don't see too many different ones.
Right.
Like, you're coming across the same few types of yokai and the same few types of human enemies. Like three or four areas into the game, and then you start to realize, are there really gonna be no variants of these? Like, you'll come across harder versions of them in like the Twilight missions, but it gets kind of like, okay, like it doesn't become easy because the game's easy. It becomes easy because you just know everything. Yeah. Like, you know how the bosses are really fucking hard, but like the enemies you're fighting are like, okay, I know how to handle all these because I've spent 30 hours fighting the same yokai over and over again. There's the hammer dude. There's the fast one. So that's a little annoying, but it doesn't stop the combat from being fun still, and the addictiveness of getting gear and seeing new bosses. And
okay,
it's a great game. Really enjoy it.
Wish that there was a demo or something. I feel like that for pretty much everything at this point. I wish that there was a demo or a decent rental service, because then I'd be able to better choose what to spend my money on. But
yeah, a demo would be nice, because they had those three like open, like alpha, beta, I mean, like a last chance trial thing they had. But like, if you miss those, like, and those did a really good job at selling the game to a lot of people. So I think it'd be neat if they just kind of had that same demo up always, because it's just a first boss area, which isn't that large of a part of the game, and like all the systems are in place. It sold me immediately as soon as I played that first alpha, and like it does a really good job of easing you into the game. I think it'd be really neat if that just stayed up forever. So like. Keeps, because the game sold a million copies already. It's doing really well for Koei Tecmo as a niche game, and as a new IP that's been in development for like 10 years.
All these games being in development for 10 years.
Yeah, must suck to make games.
Yeah.
But yeah, I recommend it if you're into those kinds of hard as nails games. If you like action games from Team Ninja, if you like Ninja Gaiden, if you like Souls, Bloodborne, yeah, it's cool. I'm enjoying it. But that is all I have been playing.
Okay.
Yeah, besides the typical multiplayer stuff.
Mm.
I'm
trying to think if there is anything else. To those curious, I don't know whether I've included... At what point in the episode or the recording I talked about my donuts. I've now only got two, four, six... I've got eight left, so I've eaten another two. The chocolate orange. The orange is super strong. It's the orange cream on top. It's like an icing. A glaze, I guess. That's a super strong orange. I wasn't quite expecting it to be quite so much, and it got caught on my mustache, so I won't pick that up again. Chocolate custard is good as always. This episode of the Pumpkin Health Podcast brought to you by Krispy Kreme.
I wish they sponsored us.
I would be so fat.
Like, look, if anyone at Krispy Kreme Co. is listening,
if any sponsor is listening to us, Blue Apron, I'd love to learn to cook. Don't ship to the UK, but maybe. Casper, if you want to send me a mattress, I sleep on a sofa right now. Nintendo, if you want to give me a Switch.
You want to send me a Switch, buddy? I'll review the Switch for it. I know I just said earlier in the episode I would never want to review things for a living, but
I'll
review
up.
That Switch for
I'll
a living.
I'll
sell
it.
Yeah.
The free stuff.
I'll take a shady deal for that Switch for sure.
Yeah.
But
I think that we should probably plug Ebby's new channels.
I was going to say,
probably should have done that earlier in the episode in hindsight, but Ebby has finally started a project of hers that she's been planning for a long time. She has it's not quite a gaming channel, because she did have one of those.
Nintendo.
Yeah, it's a Nintendo themed channel, and if you're familiar with her sort of anime channel, I think that it's going in a similar sort of vein. It's going to be it's a shame she's not here to discuss it. It's sort of discussions of games that she's enjoyed or not enjoyed. It's sort of not quite review, not quite top 10 list or whatever. It's just enjoying Nintendo and everything that comes with it, and the links for that will be in the description for both YouTube and for VidMe.
She
is uploading to both, so if you don't like VidMe, you can still check it out on YouTube. Her first video out of my favorite Nintendo games, I think.
Yep. Yeah, check it out. It's high quality stuff. Good writing, good editing.
Editing's good. So good, in fact, that she was verified instantly. I'm considering doing a video this week, I will say, about 1-2 Switch. Like a little quick fire this is what a game, each game is. Is it good? Is it bad? What's it do? Because that has been the worst part about 1-2 Switch is no one knows how many games there are for a start. Some people think there's 5. Yeah. Some people think there's 28. I'm now counting 31. it's ridiculous. So yeah, I'm going to try and get that done. Well, are you doing anything YouTube-wise, Bill?
I was going to write an anime video the other day.
Yeah?
But I didn't.
Sounds about right.
but I will plug the other thing I do.
Oh, yes.
If you're interested in hearing me talk about video games, I'm not sure if I've ever plugged it on here before.
I think you might have for the first episode, but...
Yeah, and I think I might have phrased it in the same way that I'm going to phrase it right now. Cross-promotion feels dirty, but I'm going to do it anyway. In terms of, like, two different brands.
Mm.
I have another gaming podcast that I'm a part of, Mixed Pixel. We recently just went audio only and podcast service only. So the first 10 episodes of that show are a video podcast. You can find them on YouTube. We'll throw a link to that channel on the bottom. Mm-hmm. Video podcasts, I can't do it anymore. It's too stressful. There's always a problem.
Yeah.
And when the show gets longer, more problems arise. File sizes are enormous, and OBS is always out of sync, no matter how many times I offset, no matter how many tutorials I look up. So I've given up doing long-form video podcasts, and I've decided for consistent output to do audio only, and you could find that at mixpixel.pinecast.co. You could also find it on iTunes or Pocket Cast or wherever the hell you listen to podcasts. You can stream it and download it at mixpixel.pinecast.co. And yeah, there's only one episode up on the podcast services. I'm not going to retroactively put up the previous 10. It just kind of makes...
Yeah.
I just don't feel like doing that. And we play to the camera a bit in those. Yeah. So like in terms of knowing the format and paying attention to doing things that wouldn't work, like referencing something visual. Yeah, so it's kind of a soft reboot. So it's kind of a decent place to jump in because it's brand new. In a way.
Cool.
So yeah, I'm gonna try to do that weekly. That is more news and topical based.
It's a bit more structured, if I recall. Than this.
Not necessarily what we do here. So it's a good companion piece.
Wow. Hating on the product.
Wait, what?
The way that you said it sounded like you hated the way that this is done compared to Mixed Pixel.
No, if I'm going to play, I actually preferred... Now, again, I love doing Mixed Pixel, and I love doing this, but I think I prefer doing this because, like, it's kind of more relaxing.
is it because you don't do any of it anymore?
I try to fit... it's been a great help. But for Mixed Pixel, I try to fit everything into an hour show.
Yeah,
and
the time constraints are the most stressful thing.
It gets a bit... just conceptual, not because I want to keep it an hour for convenience, but because I want to keep it an hour show, just because I've never done that before, and I'd like to kind of keep it flowing that way. And it can get kind of stressful, and certain conversations can suffer because of it, so I'm still trying to find my groove there, guiding that along. And both my hosts are brand new to podcasting, so in terms of that, it's a really rough go at it, but I'm gonna keep trucking along with that. Good. So you can check that out. Yeah, and that is it, baby.
I'm not sure. This past month has been a bit crazy in content from this channel. I think I realized that so far in 2017 we've already had 5 videos. I don't think that there's as much planned for the next month until episode 30, but if there is, it'll come out on a Monday, as always. And let us know what you...
Sweet.
There hasn't been much commenting, I'm afraid. So let us know what you thought of the Final Fantasy spoiler cast. We'd love to actually know whether you think that's something that's worth continuing. I was surprised how well it's done, considering it's a spoiler cast.
Yeah. Good job on that, by the way. I think I've told you that already in a
shout-out
tweet.
Yes.
But yes, the format was good with the pictures
and
everything.
And the sweet, sweet outro.
Yes, yes. I enjoyed it quite a bit.
Yeah.
Funny story about Stand By Me, really quick, sorry. I was at a bar 3 weeks ago, and there was this dude playing acoustic, like playing covers with an acoustic guitar, and I kind of wanted him to leave really bad because, like, when I'm drunk, I really like playing songs on the jukebox because I like that. It makes me feel happy. But this fucker kept playing for hours, and like he was good and all, but like after like this 2.5 hours, like, dude, you're not Bruce Springsteen. Could you please leave like the bar now or like stop your set? But I guess it was kind of a, like, paid him and he could play as long as he wants. But I think he overheard me at some point. I get really loud when I'm drunk. I'm loud naturally, but like drunk, it's like the volume is turned all the way up. And, I was talking about Final Fantasy with my one friend, and I kind of referenced the guy playing guitar and how, like, I wish he would leave, or if he didn't leave, could he at least play Stand By Me? And, like 25 minutes later, he starts playing Stand By Me and, I just kind of look at my friend. I'm like, uh-oh. Like, I guess I underestimate how loud I am. But it was a good version of Stand By Me. And I bought him a beer. So, yeah. Stand By Me. Good song. I wish you were playing the... What's that called? The Zubiphone? The Melodica? The
Melodica, yeah.
The Melodica. Not the Zubiphone.
The Zubiphone is completely different to what you previously called it. The Azusaphone. There's too many names for this thing.
Any more stuff you want to plug?
Nope, I don't think so. Other than to come back around the end of March for the next episode.
Share us with your friends again. Every time we kind of have new stuff popping up. I know we've been really inconsistent and it's just always kind of been the nature of Permadeath, and like any consistency in audience retention goes to the wayside too when your show becomes inconsistent. So we've been ramping that back up, and we've been doing a really great job at it. So if you like what you hear, do let us know that, and also spread us about, retweet anything, share us, whatever. If you like what you hear, tell your friends. They might like it too, because they're your friends, and friends support one another by sharing the same podcast.
Yeah.
That's how friends stay friends. You can follow us on Twitter at PermaPodcast. You can find us on iTunes. That's always a nice thing. You can also find us on Pocket Cast. Anywhere that RSS feeds feed into, all the podcast services, we're there, baby.
Mm-hmm.
You can follow me on Twitter at PepperedHam. Ken Ross, where you at, my friend?
KenRoss07.
Nice.
Yeah. And Abby at BizarreJelly5.
Yes. Follow us on the Twits. That's all the kids are saying on Twitter these days. Check me out on the Twits, baby.
It's a good book.
Yeah. Next time we see you, we'll have some Switch stuff to talk about.
I'm so sorry.
I didn't mean that as a joke initially.
No.
I was being serious because, like, we will have played the Switch by then. Yeah. And then I realized what we just had a big long spiel earlier about how we talk about the Switch so much. And then it just seemed like a joke then. Like, next time we're talking about the Switch. But in all seriousness, next time we will be talking about the Switch. And I'll have some Horizon Zero Dawn impressions as well.
I look forward to that, guys.
I'll be playing that this week. And, yeah, so look forward to it. Please look forward to it.
Please.
Goodbye.
Bye-bye.